It's a great day to play in Greenville, South Carolina. The colors of fall on this campus mean purple. We're serving up a good one this afternoon. It's Furman against VMI. Greenville, South Carolina, and Paladin Stadium, home to the number one team in the Southern Conference, the Furman Paladins, who are also ranked number 9 in the nation. They are getting ready to take on their SoCon rivals from Virginia, the Cadets of VMI. And good afternoon, everybody. Welcome inside Paladin Stadium. Along with Coach Sam Weich, I'm Bob Mahalik. Glad you could be with us. For Furman, there's no complication. It's simple. Win this week, win next week, and they're the SoCon champs. And they've got VMI in here today, Coach, a team they've beaten 25 out of 26 times. But Coach Clay Hendricks of the Furman Paladins says this Cadet team is the best he's ever seen.
Yep, and there's a difference between best and being very good. This team is very good. And not only are they better than they've been before, but they've got a passer that is as good as anybody and a running back that will break tackles in this ball. This is going to be a good one.
Yeah, they call it the air raid offense. It's a second-year offense. It spreads the football out. They throw the ball a lot, but it's really based on a running game. And Alex Ramsey's terrific at running back.
Well, you know, when you spread it out, that's your best formation for the running game. And Alex Ramsey is a top running back who will break tackles.
He will break tackles, and he leads the league in scoring. Meanwhile, for the Furman Paladins, a change on offense. Last week, Hamp Sisson came off the bench and saved the day at quarterback, and he has earned the start today.
Earned is the key verb there, my friend. He earned it because he came in there with a spark and got the team going when they were down. But Granger will be back. We got two good quarterbacks.
We'll see how Sisson handles the responsibility of being the starter for the number 9 team in the nation. We'll kick it off between Furman and VMI when we come back.
It's game time.
Dude, that was Luke Kuechly.
It's game time. It's game time. It's game time.
Thanks, Luke Kuechly.
It's game time.
I know, Luke. It's game time. Now help me with these groceries.
It's game time.
Something brought us here to a time and a place where your decisions can actually drive change. Where extra achievers become ultra-curricular. Where a private institution serves a greater public mission. At Furman University, opportunity is all around you. So take our commitment. Combine it with everything you're capable of, and the world will be forced to take notice.
Since the year 00, we was out to get more. Bunch of really real G's burning trees till we low. Sitting by 45 like I'm Jordan on the flow. Here we go against the greatest, what they say my name for.
Yeah.
Well, you won't have to wait long to get a look at that VMI air raid offense because it's the Keydets that will start the game on offense. Grayson Atkins, the all-SOCON kicker, gets us underway on a beautiful Saturday afternoon in Greenville, South Carolina. You can't make a college football day any better than this. We're framed by the foothills, lots of colors on the trees. We got the number one team in the SOCON, winners of two in a row, the Furman Paladins, taking on VMI. The Keydets, after a really great start, got out the 3-1 in SOCON play. They've lost two in a row, so today we see how they bounce back, and Reese Udinski certainly leads the way.
Well, they've got an offense that can score a lot of points. The only reason they lost that last one was turnovers. They gave up the ball five times in that ball game, but they cut that out. They would have won the last one against Western Carolina.
Last time the Paladins were at home 3 weeks ago, they lost to the Citadel in the game, which they never really found a rhythm. So we'll see what kind of start they get out to here at home against VMI. And we talk about that air raid offense, and they run it on first play right up the gut. And making the stop is Jordan Willis, one of the seniors who was just honored here for Senior Day, the senior captain. You see the air raid spread offense. Udinski under center will throw a lot of those safe passes, a lot of those 5 and 6 yard passes, and he gets a lot of guys involved in the offense. That's Leroy Thomas, a freshman, making the catch there. They have an outstanding sophomore receiver in Jacob Harris. They got Lara, who can stretch the field. So this VMI team has a lot of offensive talent.
You notice Reese Udinski, the quarterback, gets rid of the ball quick. A lot of quick throws, not far down the field necessarily. Just keep punching the ball, making first downs.
He faces his first third down situation in the game.
Big play for Furman. They can shut him down on 1-2-3 here. That's a great start for the Paladins.
A VMI offense that averages more than 30 points per game. Under pressure and goes down. So the Paladins get into the backfield immediately, and it's Adrian Hope, the All-American who had a fantastic freshman season. Gets the sack. It is his fifth sack of this year, and Hope has been a little bit quiet this season, but certainly makes his presence felt on the first series of the game, and it's kind of a big game for Hope, right? When you're finally facing a team that's going to pass the ball a lot, and that plays right into Hope's hands.
Absolutely. He's still in the running for that Buck Buchanan Award for the Defensive Player of the Year.
Well, he went four games without a sack in the middle of the season. Now he's got a sack in three straight games for the Paladins, and great coverage downfield, by the way, for the Paladins, allowing Hope time to get in there and get to the VMI quarterback.
Line drive punt gave a Furman a return of about 5 yards.
Well, so far, it's a perfect start to the game for the home team, the Furman Paladins, as they'll take over near midfield. Keys to the game, coach, as Furman takes on VMI here at Paladin Stadium. And one of the keys is, for every team, you got to avoid those turnovers.
Yeah, you can't have turnovers. Control that clock if you're Furman University. And expect a lot of trick plays if you're on defense for Furman, and wrap up those tackles. They've got a terrific running back in Ramsey.
Ham Sisson will throw on first down and complete to the senior Thomas Gordon, a four-year starter at wide receiver. Gordon honored literally just moments ago as one of the seniors, and they get the ball to him immediately, and you got to think that maybe George Quarles and the offense designed it that way to get the senior a touch here on the first play of the game.
All the seniors are going to get involved, hopefully, in this ball game. If you're a Furman fan, give them one last look. But at the same time, you've got to win this ball game and win next week against Wofford to take the Southern Conference title.
Devin Wynn up the gut, picks up only two.
Remember, Furman is playing right now for, this is the playoffs, in effect. He's playing for a title, Southern Conference title. VMI is not. VMI is playing to continue a terrific season, and they are a good football team that is going to contend from now on. They've got the quarterback and the running back to do it, both of them coming back next year.
The one area of improvement needed for VMI is on defense. They've been gouged a couple times. They've given up more than 30 points per game. They've got to tighten it up on defense a little bit. And the Paladins will try and exploit that by doing just that, doing the power game, using the big guys up front, and then power football as well, as Corey Watkins goes straight up the gut and picks up the first down.
You know, you mentioned their defense giving up 30 points. Furman only gives up less than 20. They give up 19.2 points a game. That's the difference in the statistics that may make the difference in the ball game, because there's going to be some points scored in this game.
Consecutive first downs for the Paladins here on their opening drive.
Checking off at the line of scrimmage here, checking with the coaches first.
Avery Armstrong goes in motion. They'll go right up the gut to Devin Wynn, and Wynn will pick up five. Oh, that wasn't Devin Wynn, as they have gone deep into the backfield now, and they bring out Dominic Roberto. That's Roberto from Fayetteville, North Carolina, out of Pine Forest High School, a freshman who is another one of those young men that's seen playing time increase as the season has gone on.
Furman's feeding them in. They got a lot of depth as well as a outstanding starting lineup.
Sisson will throw. Straight drop back and complete. To the 10. A nifty little move and still on his feet down to the 5-yard line. So Ryan DeLuca, the junior wideout, picks up the first down. DeLuca with his 13th catch of the season.
VMI being a military school, the last one they faced, the Citadel, certainly this game went in a totally different way. Furman comes out, looks ready to play, and they look aggressive and positive in what they're doing.
I formation at the 5-yard line, first and goal. Up the middle, Devin Wynn. Wynn with the surge. Powell's moving. Still going, no whistle, and brought down, we think, around the 2-yard line.
Wow. I don't know when they decide to blow the whistle, I'll just be honest with you about that. Supposed to win, there's no more forward momentum, but as long as those linemen are shoving, there's a little bit. All the way down to the 2-yard line, he really got hit about the 5-yard line.
Well, Hamp Sisson gave a nice assist on a touchdown last week as a quarterback pushing a running back across. This time, Devin Wynn doesn't need much because he is in for the touchdown. Impressive opening drive for Furman as they march 52 yards and take the early 6-0 lead.
52 yards of mistake-free football, by the way. Good blocking up front by the offensive line, doing a terrific job. We're going to take a close look at that as the game goes along at the individual blocking assignments on both sides of the ball and stopping a very powerful offense that VMI has. Furman's defense made a statement there as well.
Well, you said the word spark. That's the word Clay Hendricks was using when referring to Hamp Sisson. It's given this team a spark. Real or imagined, it works. Atkins' point after is good. And the Furman Paladins with a perfect start to this football game. They force the 3-and-out, then they march right downfield. And Furman, the number 9 team of the nation, is up early on VMI 7-0. Great start for Furman. They have the early 7-0 lead thanks to a Devin Wynn 2-yard touchdown plunge. It was set up by an Adrian Hope sack that forced VMI to go 3-and-out. Paladins got good field position, and here we go again. Second kickoff of the game. This is a short returnable one, and they have a good one to return it. Corey Britty is an outstanding special teams player for VMI. You see that burst of speed right there. Late flag comes in as he takes it out to the 27-yard line, so hold on to everything while we wait for the flag. But keep an eye on number 1, Britty. He's an all-SOCON special team performer.
by the way, the rules say that he could have fought fair catch that one and it would have gone back to the 25-yard line. He made it outside the 25 to the 28-yard line. But you run the risk of a penalty of a holding call. Let's see what happens. There it
is. 26, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down VMI.
It doesn't matter what football game you're watching at what level. There's always penalties on special teams. It makes you wonder why you just don't take it at the 25 every time.
I know it. Well, I think it's a good policy. I mean, you would start at the 25 with no potential of any any penalty setting you way back.
First down run up the gut, and the Paladins are there to stop it after two.
Furman looks really aggressive on defense right now, which also leaves you vulnerable if you get too aggressive, somebody getting behind you for the long throw. But so far, Furman looks very solid on defense. VMI is still trying to find the answer.
Reese Udinski flares it out, complete to Jacob Harris, and Harris will plunge forward for a few, setting up a third down and four.
You know, that's a formation and a play that you see every team have where they put two or three receivers to one side. Two of them are really blockers, and the other one's going to catch a pass behind the line of scrimmage. It's really a wide screen is what it is. That was their play on second down. Now it's third.
Alex Ramsey gets the carry. Ramsey gets to the corner and gets the first down. Boy, you talked about breaking tackles. Furman had him behind the sticks. And Ramsey was able to break free and pick up his first down of the football game.
You have to wrap up every tackle. You can't expect to knock him off his feet. And basically, more than that, you've got to gang tackle. Get help.
That's one of your keys of the game. Turn Ramsey loose. Get him some touches and get his motor rolling. And picks up two on first down there.
One of the best running formations is a split-out formation. You take a lot of people out of the what's called the box, the tight end to tight end defensive seven, you know, because they've got to get back in coverage. Makes for the running game. You got a good running back, and they do, and Alex Ramsey.
Four wideouts, and they'll run. Britty. We mentioned what an outstanding kickoff return man he is, and he's a talent that they're gradually involving into this offense a little bit more. Lots of bits and pieces. Coach Wackenheim over there at VMI made a bold decision a couple of years ago. He switched to this air raid offense, very unconventional for a military school. But look at the results. After winning one game over the last 2 years, they're in contention to win the SoCon this year, 3-3 in the conference. They were 3-1 at one point. So Wackenheim's decision to be bold has VMI playing a more exciting brand of football and winning football.
Absolutely. He's a terrific coach. I'll tell you what, he's a no-nonsense coach, too. There goes that long throw that I thought might be in play.
Brian Oakay had the coverage, the senior safety, making his 35th career start, a preseason all-SoCon performance. Pretty good coverage on Harris, but a catchable ball potentially just out of his reach.
Yep, fourth down. That's two in a row now. Three and out the first time, and I don't know how many snaps that was, about six of them maybe, something like that.
They picked up a first down.
Last punt was line drive punt, which gave Furman a chance to return it. See if they change. No, they don't try to rush it. They block. This one's going to get a roll, a good roll.
Great kick
by
King.
A good roll. Didn't quite make it in the end zone.
Executed almost perfectly as King kicked it to the open field, but it just kept on
rolling. We need a timeout on the
Paladins field. Will have the ball again. They lead 7-0. When we come back to Paladin Stadium in Greenville, South Carolina.
And up, down, jumping jacks again. Go up. Don't forget to breathe.
Your granddaughter bought you a new car?
Hey, Gigi, check it out.
Oh, this kid gets me.
Come on in, ladies. Water aerobics with these guys.
Have mercy.
Your life could be exciting enough. If not, play Powerball.
are those who don't and those who do. Let's do.
You missed something very special during the commercial break. It's Military Appreciation Day here at Paladin Stadium, and we just honored a 100-year-old veteran of World War II. While that was going on, both teams were huddled up, worrying on their strategy and getting ready to go out here and play.
Right.
Both teams stopped, acknowledged the ceremony, and gave an ovation to the veterans who serve our country. Just a really classy move from two great schools.
Impressive.
Two great programs. Very impressive.
It very well, it much, and from two great programs, led by two coaches that have that, would like to instill those thoughts in their players.
Well, Coach Hendricks coached at the Air Force in between stints here at Furman,
right.
And Coach Wackenheim is an Air Force grad, so a lot of military background involved in both of these programs, and you can see the respect level during that timeout as both these teams gave a rousing ovation to the veterans of this country who have allowed them to enjoy a Saturday afternoon like this, right, and get a scholarship and have a country with a great economy and opportunities, and these young men get it. That's one of the great things about the Southern Conference, and you talk about when you play a Citadel and a VMI and Furman and Wofford. These are just great academic schools. They're all terrific in the SOCOM, but they really stand out on a Saturday afternoon. Hampsisson will throw on first down. Pass is scooped up by Thomas Gordon, and he'll pick up 8 yards on a first down catch and run.
Quick
second
throws.
Catch of the game.
Getting the ball off in a hurry. Thomas Gordon makes a really, that's a tough catch to keep your feet. Anytime you throw the ball, we always coach the quarterbacks, keep it above the waist and below the eyes. You don't want it down below the waist because you lose your feet many times just trying to make the catch.
And that whole play is set up for Thomas Gordon's feet, so he can be moving forward and he can pick up positive yardage. Second down and two. Sisson will attempt the throw under pressure. Chucks it down the middle to Gordon, who makes the catch inside the 40 down to the 37-yard line. Terrific catch by Thomas Gordon. And a good job by Sisson hanging in under pressure to make the throw. Off balance, but you talk about a spark. You talk about the it factor. This is it.
Good pressure by VMI. Terrific avoiding the pressure by Sisson. You know, some quarterbacks just have that knack. They don't really practice it much. It just comes naturally.
You know, we talk a lot about Simpson assuming the starting role here today after coming off the bench last week, but it was a very competitive camp. Clay Hendricks says that Darren Granger won the starting job, but it was close. It wasn't some over-the-top where Granger's our dominant number one. Right. He mentioned from week one, from day one, that he could possibly use both quarterbacks. What was positive was that Granger played so incredibly well for the Paladins that Sisson couldn't find his way onto the field. Now he does.
I'll make a prediction that both these quarterbacks are going to play a role in the playoff run before the, even though the season is nearing its end. Both of them are going to see action and be an important part of it.
Here's a unique formation from the Paladins, one we haven't seen very much of. And they'll run the option out of it. Sisson with the pitch. It's to Corey Watkins, the speedster out of Georgia. Watkins! Down inside the 10, and another positive big splash play from the guys in purple and gray.
Wow, I will tell you, that one had a lot of parts to it. Let's take another look. Solid blocking up front. Slow down that chase. They can't get out there to become a part of the tackling. And those offensive linemen get very little credit for him. We're going to try to give him some today.
Yeah, that's Evan Jumper, a freshman now starting at center. And Jumper did a terrific job of sealing the right side of the line. So the Paladins inside the red zone again. Sisson complete to Avery Armstrong down to the 1 yard line. So Armstrong with his 8th catch of the game, almost a touchdown, but he's down to the 2.
What's the receiver? Now, this ball is right where it has to be, outside of the, so he doesn't slow him down. And the receiver puts both hands over that ball, covering it up. A lot of good technique, details by the Furman Paladins so far today.
Paladins, the best red zone team in the nation. 29 of 30 times they have scored. Devin Wynn scored earlier in the game. Devin Wynn down to the goal line, but does not get in.
You know, they started on the 8-yard line. It's tough when you're in the 8, 9, 10 yard because you can't make a first down. You've got to score, and you can't run deep because there's an inline. The end zone is only 10 yards deep.
It's power football. Devin Abrams, 32. is the fullback, Devin Wynn, 22. The All-SoCon tailback, Hamp Sisson, under center. They'll give it to Wynn, who walks it in. Touchdown, Furman.
Wow. I'll tell you, that was outstanding blocking on the right side. They collapsed the defense all the way down. And Wynn can walk in because there's a giant hole there.
Here's what comes to mind to me, Coach. The last time we sat in this booth here in this stadium was 3 weeks ago. It was homecoming. Furman was ranked in the top 10 in the nation. And we'll get to that in a minute because they're doing the goofy play here for the two-down. It's like two-down conversion, and they get it, and it works. Hey, the Paladins are breaking out everything as Jack Harden comes off the bench and walks it in for the two-point conversion. So it's a 15-0 lead for Furman. So we've seen some new formations from the Paladins, and they have a 15-0 lead. And we'll finish our thought about how focused and enthusiastic the Paladins are today compared to a couple of weeks ago. VMI has never won in Paladin Stadium. Old SoCon rivals, very similar schools, similar enrollment. VMI actually smaller than Furman, of course, the military angle with VMI. And they've got Mo as their mascot. Sir Paladin for the Furman Paladins. Two outstanding institutions and two good football teams. And right now, VMI needs to find a little something. Maybe they can get that spark from the special teams. And Corey Britty, who takes it at the 5-yard line. He's got speed and a couple of blocks up the gut and out to the 28. No flags. Now to the 30-yard line. And so third chance now for VMI to try and get something going offensively. As we were going to break, Coach, I wanted to reference 3 weeks ago when the Furman Paladins were out here playing Citadel. It was homecoming. Furman was on top of the world, just like they are now, top of the standings, ranked in the top 10. And for lack of a better word, they laid an egg. They had a tough game. Nothing clicked. You said when the game was over, what's important is that Furman doesn't let this loss beat him twice.
The difference between championship games and or teams and good teams is the championship teams don't lose two games the same way. They fix the mistakes. Furman has done that.
Big time. They've been a great road team. They have won six in a row, six conference games on the road. That's the most they have won on the road since the early 90s. And Coach Hendricks wants them to be a dominant team at home. They weren't 2 weeks ago against the Citadel. They struggled. They never really got it going offense or defense or special teams. Today, they're clicking on all cylinders, and it's a totally different atmosphere here at Paladin Stadium.
Beautiful day. There is just a little bit of breeze. I think that's what's keeping the Atkins kickoffs from going in the end zone right now.
Look at that touch. That's the Udinski we're going to see through the rest of the game. What a beautiful throw. Reception is made by Leroy Thomas, an over-the-shoulder grab, and this is why Udinski is racking up 300 yards per game in the air. Drop it right in the bucket.
That's a big time, whether you play for VMI, Alabama, Clemson, whatever, that's a big time throw.
Alex Ramsey with the run, gets it out near midfield, picks up a couple. They needed that throw. They needed that big play. They needed that spark. And Udinski, I mean, his numbers this year, we'll go through them all and I'll put them up on the screen, but what really was incredible was that record of going 368 attempts, no interceptions, 368. That's a coach's dream.
One interception.
And it was last week, yep.
That was last week.
Safe throw there, picks up 4 yards.
Big third down coming for VMI right now because they have not sustained a drive yet. Still in the first quarter, though, but they have not had a chance to sustain a drive.
Might be four down territory. They are in Furman territory for the first time of the football game.
It's an unusual look for VMI. Normally they're in that tight option, no more.
Yeah, it is strange to see VMI line up like this, but you get used to it. It's the new air raid offense. They'll try and run it. Occasionally they do their pickup only one, and now Coach Wackenheim has a big decision to make. It is fourth down and two. You're down 15-0 on the road. You have the ball at the 45-yard line. I don't think there is a decision. You go for it. So here's Udinski going for it on fourth down, trying to get a play call from the sideline. What they'll do is they line up there. Coaching staff up top signals down what Furman's doing defensively, and the change is made. They'll slip Ramsey over to the right side. Crowd on their feet making noise. Udinski with time. Floats it deep to Harris. Leaping grabs, got it, and will walk it in for the touchdown. Jacob Harris, an outstanding sophomore wide receiver, gets his sixth touchdown of the game, and it comes on a fourth down pass, 43-yarder.
Well, we talked about it earlier that when you're playing the way Furman is playing right now, you just hold your breath that they're not going to go for the home run. And they obviously did on a fourth down play of all things. But that's the confidence they have in their passing game at VMI.
Well, that's a freshman, Hugh Ryan, on the coverage. He goes 6 feet. He's out of Dutch Fork High School down in Columbia. Had pretty good coverage, but Jacob Harris is such a threat. He's a tall guy, 6'4", and he's one of those players they call it a 50-50 ball, right? But with a player as good as Harris, it's more one of those 70-30 balls where the offensive guy has the advantage. So VMI, desperately needing the big play, comes up with one on fourth down and makes it a 15-7 game.
You know what? Once they have made that play, they'll come back to it. The confidence also builds on the sideline to make the call again.
Well, Coach Clay Hendricks now has a chance to motivate his ball club. Coach made a great point, as he always does. We talked to him this week. He said every coach wants to play meaningful football games in November. And since he showed up here 3 years ago, every game in November has meant something. In year number one, they get to the playoffs and win a playoff game. Year number two last year, they're co-champions of the conference. Now they have a chance to get what he really wants. A solo championship and some deep playoff run.
Well, meaningful means that you're making your move into the playoffs and maybe into a bowl game. You can have meaningful games that are, you know, that are really not meaningful. What they are is kind of setting you up for next year, finding out who the players are that are going to perform for you the following year. But you're still out of everything. Meaningful means you've got a chance to playing those postseason games, and Furman is sitting in that position right now. But they're back. VMI is back in this ball game all big time, 14-7.
Returnable kick for the Paladins.
I said 14, 15-7. I went for two the last time.
And so that two-point conversion now makes a little bit of a difference. As Paladins get the ball out to around the 20-yard line. DeJuan Bell with the return.
There will be a difference in the energy on both sides of the ball for VMI after that scoring drive, especially the way they performed it on fourth down for taking the chance on the long pass. Look for them to look a lot more confident.
Sisson gives it to Wynn. Wynn tries a spin off of tackle, avoids a loss, and picks up two.
Gang tackling, a lot of players around that ball. Straight up, handoff run, first down. Furman, on that first drive, you remember, they were gaping holes in there. Right now, VMI seems to be stiffening up their defense.
Last year against VMI, Devin Wynn had three touchdowns. He has two already today. He enjoys playing against the Cadets.
Shotgun formation, two backs in the backfield, along with the quarterback.
Thomas Gordon, fourth time he's touched the ball in this football game, and picks up another Furman first down. Thomas Gordon, four-year starter, featuring him in the offense here in the first quarter.
Watch the burst at the very end of the set, and the quick stop. That is designed so that the quarterback is actually in motion. His arm is back, ready to release the ball when Gordon turns around. You know, it's about a 20-yard, 25-yard pass down to the sideline, just not down the field. Furman shifting back into that shotgun again. Anytime you get a running back behind the quarterback, he's a potential ball carrier. And there he is. He's got it.
On the option, Wynn gets nothing. Wynn working on a 1,000-yard season, but gets stopped here on first down.
Yep.
Could be the final play of the first quarter. A very entertaining and exciting first quarter. We've seen three touchdowns and a wacky two-point conversion. That's the difference in a 15-7 game. And the Paladins are going to let the clock run down. First place in the SoCon is on the line. Furman sits atop the league right now. They need a win today to stay there. VMI, though, is making a statement. They trail only 15-7 after one. Scott Wackenheim, in his fifth year at VMI, has some quality wins on his resume this season. Wins over East Tennessee State, the Citadel, and Samford. Now he's trying to knock off number one in the SoCon. His team will have to step it up a little bit on defense. Furman has scored on the first two possessions. This is possession number three, and Hamp Sisson's throw is knocked out of the air. First incompletion of the game off the right arm of Sisson, and he had two open receivers, but the ball got deflected before it could reach its intended target.
Hey, Sisson was not deep in his retreat because he was faking a run play and then throwing the ball, and that's why the knockdown came. The ball didn't have time to gain any height on the flight of the ball.
I mean, he had Abrams. That was a touchdown. Devin Abrams was wide open. They may go back to that play as this game rolls on.
Right.
First incompletion. Sisson making his first start of the season, 6 of 7, 85 yards. Controlled rollout. VMI bench says no catch. And they're correct.
Ball a little bit low. That's a second below the waist throw that Hamp Sisson has made here in the ball game.
All right, so for the first time of the game, the VMI defense has held. And, Coach, you talked about it. That one big play on offense has inspired the entire team. Now the defense steps up, makes a stop, and Grayson Atkins will have to punt it away. Decent kick. Fair catch signal is given. And like one of Coach's outstanding wedge shots into a green, it takes one skip and comes to a conclusion around the 21-yard line. So here comes VMI, buoyed by their last possession, in which they went for it on 4th-and-2 and ended up throwing a 43-yard touchdown pass. But that's what we expect from this VMI air raid offense. And, Coach, it's the second year of the air raid. And Coach Wackenheim was saying earlier throughout the season that, you know, the system has to grow on you, the quarterbacks, the offensive line, the wide receivers. It's new to everybody. And once you get into a situation where you're those guys, including the offensive linemen, and you start to get comfortable, you stop thinking, you start playing. And that's where you want your guys going. You don't want them out there thinking too much.
I think they're there. They've had a half a season now, more than a half a season, to get comfortable, to get used to this style of play. Actually, it's more fun if you want to know the truth.
Of course it is. And it's easier to recruit. And Alex Ramsey picks up the first down and makes a nifty move. And Ramsey's numbers are just ridiculous. He's had some monster games this year. He's averaging more than 119 yards per game on the ground. He'll catch the ball coming out of the backfield. I mean, against Western Carolina, he had three touchdowns. Against Samford, that overtime game, number 36 right there. Six touchdowns.
Came into this game with 1,078 yards already.
Yeah, he leads the conference in attempts, yardage, and touchdowns. He has 20 of them. He had a 200-yard game against Wofford. Udinski averages about 300 yards in the air. Has Harris open and overthrows him just a hair. Harris stumbled a little bit coming out of his break, or it may have been another six for VMI.
Very similar play to the one that got batted down by the defense of VMI when Hamp Sisson tried to call fake the run and throw the pass, but it was a short pass, so the ball was on line throwing. This one was a lofted throw, of course, down the field, just overthrown.
The better VMI stretches the field, the better Ramsey will run with space between the tackles as those safeties. A lot of pressure on a Brian Oke and DeMarcus Clay today. And to say that Oke steps up and makes the tackle initially, but you talked about Ramsey breaking tackles. Should have been a 6-yard gain. Instead, it's close to a first down.
It is a first down, and this is the kind of runner he is. He is a big guy to begin with, so he's going to be a big load up in the line, whether he's got a power run or a sweep run. He's got speed as well. I'll tell you what else he has. He's got good instincts. He cuts back against the grain without any effort at all.
So after a bit of a slow start, this VMI offense starting to find their way. It's Ramsey again, and again with some room. Stopped right at the 50-yard line.
Gang tackling, and it took all of them to push him back. Ramsey is a guy that had 214 carries coming into this game for 1,078 yards, averaging 5 yards a carry. Longest run this year is 47 yards. He can break it.
And once again, you see VMI sort of goes into a hurry up where they line up quickly, but then they slow it down, get the plays called in from the sideline. So it's not a hurry up offense. It's more of a no huddle offense at times.
It's the threat of a hurry up.
Ramsey's got room. Alex Ramsey, leading rusher in the SoCon, leading touchdown man in the SoCon, has number 21 for the season. And VMI now has cut the lead down to two. Alex Ramsey, sensational.
He's a special guy, and he can break it. And they just kept pounding until they found that cutback hole. It was a beautiful run. He runs straight up and down, doesn't he? Not a forward lean in his run at all. Now they're going to go for the one, so this will still leave them down by one, 14-13.
Point. Could be the difference of the game.
Gardner again now.
After is good, and here comes VMI with 14 unanswered points. We've got ourselves a ball game here in Greenville, South Carolina. Come back. It's going to be fun.
Something brought us here to a time and a place where your decisions can actually drive change. Where extra achievers become ultra-curricular. Where a private institution serves a greater public mission. At Furman University, opportunity is all around you. So take our commitment, combine it with everything you're capable of, and the world will be forced to take notice.
Yeah, the Furman Paladins are trying to win a SoCon title. Getting a win today in front of the home folks will certainly move them in that proper direction. Later today in the Southern Conference, Wofford, also with only one loss in the conference, is on the road at Macon, Georgia, taking on Mercer, Chattanooga, Samford, ETSU, and Western Carolina. All those games coming up a little bit later on in a competitive Southern Conference. Furman leads the conference at 5-1, Wofford 4-1 right behind them. It's a 15-14 game here, too, as VMI has made the big comeback. DeJuan Bell calls for the fair catch, as coach has indicated. Why take any chances? Take the ball out at the 25-yard line and let your offense get it done. So now, for the first time in the football game, we've got a little bit of a flip. The offense of Furman moved it down the field the first two times they touched it, but they got stopped by VMI in their last possession.
Furman is doing good things. They know where... They've had success. Look for them to come back to it a little bit, see if they can do it again. Get back in the lead, or a more comfortable lead in this game. They lead by one.
This little diamond formation sort of here as they run it to the right side. Sisson will keep and move forward and pick up a few. Ham Sisson has good feet. They really think he's a good athlete with good feet, and he's very decisive, coaches say. Once he decides if he's running the ball, there's no doubt about it, he's running. If he decides he's got an open man, he's going to make the throw. So for a young man who hasn't seen a lot of live bullets, as Coach Bowden used to like to say, he seemed to have handled the situation very well.
Two good quarterbacks, honestly, that generally handle it well, and they're going to be here for another two or three years, too.
Sisson with a straight drop back, chucks it down the right side of the field and just a little too far. Intended for Thomas Gordon, but outstanding coverage from VMI, and it's going to set up a third down and long.
When you take a shot like that, you run the risk of coming up with a third and long or a second, third, fourth down and long, because you're going for the big gun, but the gamble is that you're putting a lot of money on the table to do it. And when you lose all of it.
Spread the field a little bit. So here, another third down. Third down and eight.
Furman, really a four wide receiver look.
Assistant quarterback draws. Got a lot of room and almost escaped and is brought down at the 30-yard line shy of the first down. That is a terrific defensive play turned in by Gerard Richmond, because Sisson had a lot of green in front of him. That was a first down, and somehow Big 97's able to run him down. Look, he sees the opening and just could not get away. Actually, it was 9-0 that got there first, so an outstanding defensive play from Ryan Clark as well, the senior.
Well, when you're not getting penetration as a pass rusher, when that draw comes open, you actually find yourself in good position, so that's what happened on that one.
Line drive kick, fair caught. Grayson Atkins is pointing at flag, so hold on to everything. There's a flag backed by Atkins who may have gotten run into at the end of that play.
If he did, and it is a roughing the kicker, it's an automatic first down versus running into the kicker for a 5-yard penalty.
Well, it's a short kick, so either way, I think Furman would like to kick it again.
Furman.
If they have that option. Let's see what the call is.
The Cadets have their head down.
Personal foul. Leaping the wedge, 32 of the defense. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic, first down.
Player safety rules put into play a couple of years ago on special teams, how you can't leap on the wedge. And there's a leap over the wedge, but boy, it looked like he got a little bit of an assist there. The flag does come in, and Atkins is pointing for it. I don't know if you could see the legs come up, but not sure he leapt as much as he was pushed into the air by the Paladin blocker. Either way, it's Furman football, and that's a good break for the Paladins early.
Big break for them, and here's finally marking it off. It looked like they were going to spot the ball in the same spot, but now they mark it off up to the 44-yard line.
Well, it's
that rule is in place really for safety,
right.
Period. And that's what it's also true on an extra point or a field goal attempt.
But right now, VMI on the sidelines a little frustrated with that call. They thought they held the Paladins, and they did. They would have gotten the ball around the 40-yard line after a fair kick by Atkins. Instead, it's Furman with the football. Now they have the ball in VMI territory.
Good first down run, leaving second down and four. A lot of options that you can go from here.
See Devin Wynn with a little apparatus adjustment. Preseason also, Con Wynn's lived up to the hype. He's over 900 yards for the season. Got a couple of touchdowns today. Last week he had 73 yards and a touchdown. They'll tighten that up on second down and four. Rollout. Lot of room. A whole lot of room for Thomas Gordon. Gordon gets it down to the 30-yard line. Well-designed play, but a late flag comes in. Looked like it might have been an unnecessary block thrown there at the last minute, possibly from Devin Abrams. But boy, that play worked to perfection. And for Furman, you hate to see a flag at the end of it because you accomplished what you accomplished. You hate to see a flag 20 yards downfield.
Well, it may be a 10-yard penalty, which would still leave them with, if it's from the spot of the foul, it's still a first down. Now the officials are conferring, discussing this one. They don't look like they care where the ball was just a minute ago. Well, they got a spotter. They got an official over there spotting it. When you get a lot of officials in the huddle like this for a long period of time, sometimes it involves, let's see what it's all.
Personal foul, blindside block, offense, number 82, 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Replay, second down.
So second down becomes almost what they just did, second down and about five this time instead of second and four.
That little block at the end from 82 it was, Ryan Miller. Again, it's one of those player safety calls where you're not really allowed to crack back, but there was almost engagement before the hit was made.
Yeah,
hey, look, on the previous play, maybe it's a makeup call. Let's leave it at that.
That one really, I don't think, is what the rule's all about. That was not a dangerous situation for anybody.
But neither was the wedge play, too. So, yeah. But again, those are in there, and the officials are trained to look for that because of player safety. Those are both calls that were made with the student-athlete in mind.
Right. I will tell you, though, in pro, college, and high school ball all the way through, the officiating has become a bigger part of the game. And the flags sometimes just are not right. Let's look at Bo. Look at some of the guys in the This is Bo Godwin, the tackle. Watch his number 65. Play is going outside. You see him coming up, making the block on the second level at the linebacker spot.
Sisson to throw under pressure. Goes down. Ball's on the turf. Flag is on the turf. All kinds of activity here. Looks like Furman has the football. We'll see what the flag is all about.
It's in the area where offensive holding would be called, unless there's a face mask grab by the quarterback. Grabbing the quarterback's face mask, obviously.
Well, they're talking to the VMI bench, so it's decision time for Wackenheim to determine whether or not he wants to march him back 10 or take the sack. I think you take the sack, right? Make it second and 15?
Yeah, I would. You know, you already got him in long distance, long range.
It's not what they're going to do.
Holding. 71 of the offense. 10 yards from the previous spot. Replay, first down.
Call goes on Jordan Harris, so it'll be a first and 20.
Yeah, they're going to mark it up. Actually, it's going to be more than first and 20. Well, that's you're about right. Okay. First down and 20. So you got plenty of downs to get it back.
On the option, Sisson keeps it. Wrangled down, and there comes another flag. Yeah. Another player safety flag is thrown.
Yeah, that's a first down for Furman.
Chuck Weatherman in the middle of it all.
And if that is a an intentional hit, that's an ejection from the game as well. Let's see what the call is.
It's a personal foul one way or the other, determining the severity of it now is.
Well, if it looked like he intended to try to hurt the player, he's out of the game.
Personal foul. Horse collar tackle. 92 of the defense. 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
Okay, no ejection.
Well, they called the horse collar.
All right, he's up. Oh, they just, yeah.
So for the.
A little bit. That one, that's a tough call. I mean, it's legit, but it's a tough call because of the all that contact in there, and he really didn't follow through on the hit.
Been a whole lot of football played between midfield and this 35-yard line over the last 4 minutes. Sisson will try and change all that as he bursts up the middle. Hamp Sisson on his way to the end zone, gets down to the 5-yard line, inside the 5 to the 4. Longest run of the season for Sisson, whose longest coming in was 20.
This, for a non-running back, is an outstanding run because of the moves he makes down the field. Look at him change direction, gaining the extra yardage, really playing off of the offensive line, gives him the start, though. Look at that offensive line pushing the defense out of the play completely, giving Sisson a chance for that great run.
That's why Andy Godwin, number 65, wears the C, the captain, moving bodies. Paladins looking for the third touchdown of the game, and they got it. Devin Wynn has got the hat trick of touchdowns, and we're still in the first half.
Bob Mahalik, I will tell you this. Marching down and eliminating the value of that VMI touchdown because the Furman came right back and scored again. Let's see if they go for two, possibly. They're lined up with it.
Well, hang on to everything, because Jack Harden ran it in for a two-point conversion last time. This time, of course, because we're ready for it, as is VMI, they're just going to line up and let Grayson Atkins, right, the all-SoCon kicker, knock it through. But you want to keep that edge.
Finish that point, though. That score by Furman right there eliminated the momentum a little bit that VMI had taken away.
Atkins puts it through, so a controversial penalty keeps the drive alive for the Paladins, but they take advantage of it. Devin Wynn has three touchdowns, and the Paladins lead 22-14. Well, sometimes the numbers just don't lie. The Furman Paladins score more than 30 points a game. VMI gives up more than 30 points a game. And so we expected a high-scoring, heavily offensive game. We've got one. 22-14 is the score, and we're not even halfway through the second quarter.
And we're seeing that the two stars that we talked about early, Alex Ramsey and quarterback Udinski, they are legit. They are big-time football players.
And on the other side, Devin Winnen, also comp performer at running back for Furman, pretty legit as well. He now has 12 touchdowns and is nearing 1,000 yards. Ramsey, over 1,000 yards, and has 21 touchdowns for the season. So some of the best in the Southern Conference playing here today at Paladin Stadium. VMI will start this drive around the 23. And, Coach, things got a little chippy on that previous drive. A couple of personal fouls, a little pushing and shoving. Game on, right? I mean, the intensity is there. You can't make it up. It seems to be there today.
Well, I think both teams feel like they're good enough to win, but they also know that they're playing a tough opponent. Each side, I think this is the respect that comes along when you get chippy, too. There's the head coach, Clay Hendricks. Played ball here at Furman on championship teams.
Assistant coach on championship teams. 10 times he's been associated with a team that's won the Southern Conference. He'd like to make it 11 and make that one time as a head coach. No doubt it'll come at some point during his career, but he certainly is primed for that right now. Another catch for Leroy Thomas, his fourth of the game. Picks up 5 on first down.
I am impressed every time I watch Udinski throw the ball, how quickly he gets it out of his cock position and releases that pass big time.
Alex Ramsey stuck by Perriman at the line of scrimmage, still able to fall forward for one, but big 44. Donovan Perriman, a senior captain, able to step up and make the hit. We honored the seniors here at Furman University before the football game, and there are certainly some quality seniors, and we've mentioned them throughout the broadcast. Weems is certainly one of them, okay, and Perriman on defense, but this is still a relatively young team for the Furman Paladins. Third down and 2.
This is a big down right here. 3 and out would mean a lot to the Paladins.
They'll throw. Udinski makes the decision to run. He's got plenty of green. Reese Udinski out to the 49-yard line. Great job by the defensive backs of the Furman Paladins, able to lock down the VMI receivers, but still Udinski able to turn it into a first down.
Nobody.
Great coverage.
Yep, nobody there. They're covered, every one of them. Locked on.
Great job by our camera crew to let you know what goes on away from the football. They flare it out to pick up 4 on first down. Rohan Martin makes his first catch of the game.
VMI, strategically, they are throwing quick throws. If you'll notice, most of them are out of the quarterback's hands in less than 3 seconds, which is that's fast. Normally it's about 4 seconds before you really get rid of a down-the-field throw.
Paladins blitz, and that leaves a man open. First down and more. First time we've called the name of Javion Lara. The senior wide receiver makes his 40th catch of the season and picks up a first down.
That may have been a blown coverage right there, Bob. That was that wide open with nobody in between. Normally you have somebody in between the flight of the ball so that if he's not covered by having somebody standing next to him, he's got a hard throw to make.
Lara's a good one, so might as well go back to him again. This time they pick up 5. Lara was the team's leading receiver last year. He had 7 touchdowns for the VMI Cadets last season. He's got 5 this year. He's more of their speed guy. Has a long of 55 back in Texas. Oh, about 5 years ago, he was one of the top sprinters in the state of Texas, a very competitive high school area, obviously. When you're in the top 10 in the state in sprinting, you got some speed. See if they go to him again here on second down. Instead, they'll go underneath. It's complete to Jacob Harris.
Furman in a very soft zone, trying to protect it down the field throw. This has been a good drive for VMI. They have answered the Furman's march down the field. And putting a lot of receivers in different positions and tough to make quick calls defensively to make sure you get them all covered. Furman goes to a zone, which cuts down your pass rush a little bit.
Empty backfield. The 6'4 Udinski, the only one standing behind the line of scrimmage. He's got plenty of time on a three-man rush, goes underneath. Harris reaches behind him to make the catch and picks up another first down. Harris has a great set of hands. And remember, he's only a sophomore, number 14. I think he's going to be one of the best the SoCon has seen.
Yeah. Not only does he make a great catch, but he makes a turn and goes straight up the field. He doesn't run sideways. Make that extra yard. This is a tough spot right here. Just outside the 10-yard line. You almost have to score a touchdown because it's tough to get a first down when you're at the 10, 11, 12-yard line.
Martin wrapped up immediately. No gain. Actually, he'll lose a yard as Quindarius Weems made the initial contact.
Another quick throw. Just get the quarterback, takes a snap, turns, and releases. Wide receivers, you got one wide receiver out to the left. This ball should be thrown to the left side there. Nobody covering the slot, man. Or go to the run.
Yeah, give it to Ramsey. It picks up three. Brought down by Drew Seabrook.
I think they were a little bit vulnerable there, Furman. And they're staying in that same formation, which may mean that upstairs they saw what I was talking about.
Third down. They can get a first down at the 1.5-yard line.
Watch the throw to the left side. If I was a quarterback reading the coverage,
single coverage,
snap.
Single coverage at the top of the screen. They'll go underneath the Harris.
Yep.
Harris gets popped at the three, falls forward. He's going to be shy of the first down. So once again, it's decision time for VMI. Do they kick the field goal in what appears to be a touchdown game, or do they go for it here inside the 5-yard line? Remember, their first touchdown of the game came on a 4th-and-3.
They're going to go for it right here. Nothing
they line up quickly, and they run it quickly. They'll roll out, and Udinski can run it in. Can he get to the corner in time? No, he's brought down, but he got the first down. Boy, Udinski had an entire open field, but he couldn't quite find that extra burst of speed. That's why he doesn't run it very often.
Looked like if he turned his right blinker on and turned off the hill.
I mean, he had it. He just couldn't outrun the Furman Paladins. Great defensive effort from Travis Blackshear, who the coaching staff has acknowledged has really improved as the season has gone on. But remember, they could get that first down. You said it was hard, but they got it inside the 1-yard line.
Yep.
So now VMI set up for their third touchdown of the game. They have first and goal from the 1-yard line.
Offense advantage.
Previous play is under further review.
So we're going to take a review to see if the knee went down before he got the first down. So give a lot of credit to Travis Blackshear. He's a redshirt freshman out of Savannah, Georgia, and he showed a little burst of speed there in running down Udinski.
Yeah.
Coming up at halftime, we'll take a look at some of the highlights. If you missed some of those previous scores, you're going to stick around to watch it. We've had 5 touchdowns in this football game already. We'll go through the halftime stats, and we'll get you caught up on what's been going on around the Southern Conference. That's coming up at halftime here from Greenville, South Carolina. But there's a lot of football to be played here in the first half still with 3:45 on the clock, VMI knocking on the door. Certainly Furman's going to get another possession one way or the other here, and VMI has only stopped Furman once. So we expected a lot of offense, and we're getting it. Let's take another look at the replay. We'll see if Udinski has the knee go down before he gets the first down. Needs to get to about the 1-yard line.
Well, it looks like there's a right there.
Boy, yeah, that's hard.
He had to stretch. Getting all of that. His knee did go down.
He had to stretch, though. Where is the football when his knee first touches the ground? And unless you have that pylon cam going, it's going to be awfully hard to tell. Remember, you have to have inconclusive evidence to overrule. The ruling on the field was first down, VMI.
Yeah, I think they've got enough evidence right there, but putting it exactly where it is, and was it still a first down, even though they gave him a little bit too much, that's the decision they got to make. It'll be fourth down and very, very short if they don't give him a first down.
Well, that was fourth down, so if he's short, that's Furman football at the 1.5-yard line.
That's right. That was fourth down. Went to sleep there for a minute, Bob. Thanks for waking me up.
Well, there's a lot going on. We've had a lot of rhythm in this football game until the final two drives, which have seen a lot of penalties and reviews and a lot of stoppage in play.
The officials are, they're spending a lot of time with this. This is not an easy decision, obviously.
Well, there's two things that go on here. Number one, you have to determine if the knee was down. Then, if you determine it was Furman football, where are you going to mark it? Well, here's what's on the line. That's why this is such a big call. Remember, VMI at one point was 3-1 in the conference. They've lost 2 in a row. The Paladins lost their first conference game at home here 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago against the Citadel. They've won two straight on the road. So Furman trying to go to 6-1 in the conference with a win today. If Wofford wins their game, that sets up a winner-take-all pretty much next week in Spartanburg as Furman would take on Wofford. But, Coach, as you think about it, you want to think SoCon Championship.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First and goal, VMI.
So they take a look at it. They couldn't find anything conclusive to overrule, and so it remains Furman on defense and VMI with the ball at the one-yard line.
First down and one. I would look for Alex Ramsey to get the ball right here.
You know, Coach, you're one of the smartest minds in football, but I'm pretty sure that that's a pretty good call. Ramsey already has one touchdown. He has 21 for the season. They'll give it to Alex Ramsey, and Alex Ramsey scores again. Good call, Coach.
The big one. Yeah, well, that was
brilliant.
That would took a lot of experience to get that. Here's the quick handoff straight ahead. Ramsey stays low. That's tough tackling right there. He can't get to his legs because he's so low. Bends over well below the waistline, and he's a powerful man to begin with. Good run, and all of a sudden we're back to a one-point game if they make this extra point.
Grant Clemens has missed only one extra point this season, 34 for 35. And VMI answers Furman's touchdown. Right now the difference in the game is a two-point conversion from Furman. They lead by one.
Since the year double O, we was out to get more. Bunch of really real G's burning trees till we low. Sitting by 45 like I'm Jordan on the flow. Here we go against the grain, that's what they say my name for. I'm just riding around my city, bank account and chair model. Sitting pretty, I just had to let them know. Yo, I'm unforgettable.
Well, we emphasized at the beginning of the broadcast that Furman would have their hands full with the VMI team that Coach Clay Hendricks says is the best VMI team he has ever seen, and certainly the proof is on the field right now. VMI has scored three touchdowns here in the first half, but so has Furman. The difference right now is a two-point conversion in which the Paladins, on their second touchdown of the game, ran a little bit of a trick play, got the two-point conversion, and that's the difference. Furman leads 22-21. Bell calls for the fair catch. They'll get the ball at the 25. But, boy, if you're familiar with VMI, this doesn't shock you this year. But if you're a Furman Paladin fan or a casual fan of the SoCon and you're used to the same old VMI, well, this isn't the same old VMI.
No.
And Wackenheim's done a terrific job. Like I said, not only are they competitive, they're just flat-out fun to watch play.
Well, they're fun to watch, and because they're different, They're a little bit tougher to, because you're not playing the same playbook you had a year ago, but they are young enough that they're going to be good for quite a while.
And it certainly helps in recruiting. I think if you're a young man that has some speed and wants to play on offense, a team that puts up numbers, I think you come to VMI. Thomas Gordon, 4-year starter, and the senior gets his fifth catch of the game.
That's a block right there, running back making sure that no defensive lineman comes in to bat that one down.
It's Devin Abrams.
Great shot. from a cameraman getting in that down in the part of the ball game that you miss much of.
They go short side, and there goes Devin Abrams, being rewarded for his outstanding block. He touches the rock and takes it 35-plus yards down the right sideline.
This is a big drive. 3 minutes and 2 seconds remaining in the half. If Furman can erase that last touchdown drive by VMI, it's a little bit of a downer for VMI because they really felt like they got back in the ballgame in a position to pull away. And if Furman can eliminate that, they're well within Atkins' field goal range, by the way, already. So we can almost count on three. He's a very accurate kicker, and especially from this range. He's long, 55 yards. He's accurate from that range, too.
Dominique Roberto is in at running back, and he gets the call. Roberto gets second carry of the game and picks up positive yardage down inside the 15 to the 14-yard line.
Clock is not a factor. Furman has all their timeouts.
If anything, they may want to slow it up to keep VMI from touching the football again here in the half.
Yeah, no rush. Coaches can slow that down a little bit by not sending that play in too fast. But you want to make sure the guys have time to think about their assignment on the play and the formation to be in and all of the details of the play.
Roberto stays in as the lone running back. They'll give it to Roberto. Left side, inside the five, down to the four, and another first down for Furman. That offensive line of the Furman Paladins is controlling the line of scrimmage. They're getting blocks 4 yards downfield.
Really doing a good job with it.
You see Roberto taking advantage of some playing time. He's got 3 rushes in the football game. Now we'll see if that sets up a nice play action as VMI backs up against the wall again. First and goal for Furman from just inside the five.
Taking their time at the line.
Sisson under center. Gives it to Dominique Roberto, gets it down to the 2-yard line.
They're making good positive yardage going off the right side that time. Evan Jumper did a good job blocking it. The right guard inside. You've got to open a hole just big enough to get through it. And when you get down in here like that, you don't have to, you know, worry about making a cut. You just head for that goal line. And it actually runs perpendicular to the rest of the field. Have you ever thought about that?
Coach, I can't think that deeply. That's all up to you.
I actually thought of it for the first time myself just now. But it's the truth.
All right, timeout called by VMI. So now Coach Walkenheim not only trying to get his defense to step it up, but also maybe preserves a little bit of clock. I mean, the VMI offense, if they're going to win football games, VMI, it's by scoring more points than the other team. They know that. Their defense is where they need to make improvements. And so you would think at this point, it's not necessarily to rally the defense. It is, hey, maybe I can get my offense the ball one more time before the half ends.
We said it earlier in the ball game, but their defense is averaging giving up roughly 35 points a game. And Furman is, their defense is giving up 19.2 points a game.
So VMI is already above that average against Furman.
Yep, and second down and 2 to go, and they're making 1 and 2 yards every time, but they bunch everybody up this time. It's gonna be muscle, man on man.
Roberto, up the middle and stopped.
Nothing.
Richmond was there to make initial contact for the VMI Cadets, and they'll call another quick timeout. That'll set up a third down and goal. Outstanding penetration from VMI. That's really the first time the Cadets in a key situation have won that battle in the trenches.
I tell you, I'm not second guessing anything that Furman's doing here because they've got they're scoring points. But when you get down there like that and you bunch everybody in, you add meat to the tackle-to-tackle line of scrimmage. If you spread people out, the coverage guys have to leave what's called the box or the middle portion of the defense. The coverage guys have to get out of there, and they become less of a punch once you slow down the running back. They don't get in there to make the pushback. I just move them out a little bit, give them the idea that it's a pass is just as likely as a run, and then pound it in there.
They'll keep Roberto in as the running back. Paladin's first three touchdowns were all Devin Wynn with short touchdown runs. This is third and goal from the two. Still a tight formation. Ham Sisson goes under center. Wynn goes in motion. Play action. Looking for Wynn. Devin Wynn. Another touchdown for the Paladins.
Great call. Terrific call by the coaching staff. They looked like they were going to be, they were still jacked in there. Had one guy split out, but that was it. It looked like another run on inside. Great ball handling by the Sisson and the running back. He carried out his fake in there. And then, of course, a perfect pass and catch and run into the end zone.
Fourth touchdown of the game for Devin Wynn, who scored three last year against VMI. Grayson Atkins, point after, is good. 29 first half points for the Furman Paladins. Hamp Sisson makes the throw. And Devin Wynn takes it in for his fourth score of the game.
How about this thought? Did Furman leave them too much time? There's 1:06 left on the clock. After the kickoff, there'll be about a minute, maybe a little bit less than a minute.
I think one of the most underrated aspects of what you used to do so well for a living as a head coach is clock management. Scott Wackenheim did a great job. He burned two timeouts, but he left his team with the minute and 6 seconds, and he still has one timeout left.
Right. And if if you're saying to yourself, we're in a game where we're not going to the playoffs, we're having a great turnaround season, you take those chances, leave yourself with some time.
And remember, Furman will receive the opening kickoff of the second half. VMI touched the ball first in this football game, so that's even more emphasis to try and get the ball one more time to get a score. They've got a pretty good field goal kicker. They've got some range, so they get within a 50-yard attempt. They can get some points on the board.
Yep.
Grayson Atkins usually puts it in the end zone, especially when he's got some wind at his back. And that's exactly what happens here.
You know, it's a colder day than – it's a cold day, period. And you don't – there's not enough – the ball doesn't go as far when you get a kick, whether it's a punt or a place kick or a kickoff. And it showed up a little bit because Atkins normally puts it in the end zone. He's only kicked it – out of bounds, missed kicking it either in the end zone or into play one time all season long. He's an accurate kicker, obviously. His long on a field goal is 55 yards, and he's capable of doing that one time after time, by the way.
Wholesale changes at the last second here for the Furman Paladin defense. They'll run Alex Ramsey up the middle looking to bust one quickly. Doesn't quite work for VMI as time ticks as they mark him down at the 30-yard line, under a minute to go.
No timeouts left for VMI. They used them on the drive.
Well, they've got one. They've got one left, but they're in no hurry to use it.
Oh, you're right. Excuse me, I missed on that.
Trying to loosen up the defense with that run up the middle, and now Udinski will throw to Harris, and Harris makes the catch in front of Chizik and gets out of bounds at the 41-yard line.
Clock stops. No need to worry about a timeout here. No need to rush to get the snap off.
And now they're one pass away from being in field goal range.
All four receivers are at quick release position.
Udinski got awfully close to the line of scrimmage and then throws an interception. Picked off by the Paladins. Darius Curse. He returns it inside the 50, and now the Paladins with three timeouts are in position to set up Grayson Atkins for a kick. And Udinski, who doesn't make mistakes, throws his second interception in as many games after going 368 attempts with that one.
And they are probably 15, maybe 18 yards away from putting Grayson Atkins, in a chance to make another long field goal for Furman.
Sisson throws complete to Devin Wynn. Flag down, though, behind the play. So hold on to everything.
That's usually a holding penalty.
Yeah, Jordan Harris is looking around like he made a proper play. The guys wearing the black and white and stripes will say otherwise.
Holding. 71 in the offense. 10 yards from the previous spot. Replay first down.
Oh, that was a big penalty. Big penalty because that put them virtually in field goal range or one play away from the field goal range. Still 24 seconds left. Furman has all their timeouts. Time for them to get right back into that position. You know, holding, I'm almost ready to suggest that there are two levels of holding. There's a 5-yard penalty and a 15-yard penalty, because a little hole like that one was, and it wasn't very much. In fact, I didn't think it was enough to count.
Set up a screen to Devin Wynn. If Wynn can get to the corner, he has a ton of room, but that was a strong, strong defensive play from BMI. Elliot Brewster, who's their leading tackler, is able to make the stop on Devin Wynn, and that's two also comp performers right there. I think Brewster and Devin Wynn coming together, and Brewster got the best of him, because if Brewster doesn't make this tackle right here, Devin Wynn has 60 yards in front of him, and he's off to the races.
It looked like he had a big one. You're right. And notice that after that, he tackles him again, which is one way of trying to eat up the clock and give Furman less time. Nothing called on the penalty. That could be delay of game, though.
Yeah, but sometimes you've been seeing in the league, because you see it on all our great ESPN top 10 plays, where you think you tackle the guy, but he rolls over top of the defensive player and he never touches the ground. You throw him forward and he keeps going. So better safe than sorry at that point. There's right. Grayson Atkins. He's got a lot of range. We watched him last year kick three 50-plus yard field goals in a football game. He's an all-SOCON performer, and quite frankly, I think he may be one of the top 10 kickers in the nation. All levels.
He'll get his shot at the NFL. There's no doubt about that when it's over, when his career in college football is over.
He actually missed one last week, and that was a remarkable headline. he had made so many in a row. When he missed one, you were shocked. Sisson throws underneath, but it's incomplete. Was trying to get it to his tight end, Ryan Miller.
Ryan Miller was not quite ready. He wasn't looking for the ball. It was, by the time he turned around, the ball was almost on him. Couldn't find it in time. It's hard to turn around and find the ball in the air. You like to see the release, or just split second after the release, so that you can time whether you need to speed up or slow down to box a defender out.
Well, we'll see what Furman comes up with on third down and 18 with 14 seconds to go. Do they run it and just run it into the locker room, or do they try and pick up a big play? Sisson will throw. Four-man rush. Steps up. Pressured from behind and makes the throw complete. Dwayne Anderson, the freshman, makes the catch at the 39. Furman calls the quick timeout, even though the clock stops as the chains move. There's 8 seconds left, and they are one completion away from being in Atkins field goal range, and they do have a timeout.
I think they're going to need to get about 7 more yards, 8 more yards to be comfortable with him. Although I don't question Atkins' ability at all.
Yeah, part of me wants to see him try a 60-yarder.
Yeah, but the ball hadn't been carrying today.
No, and there's a little bit of the wind's picked up a little bit just now, and it's a little bit of a crosswind, it appears.
Yeah,
so it's not necessarily helping.
Look at the American flag over there, though. It is a little bit too. He's got a little bit of a tailwind.
I think a little bit of a help.
Yep.
Well, there's 8 seconds, so I'm not sure you have a chance to shoot one into the end zone here and still have a chance to kick. So we'll see if they just go underneath, call the timeout, and run the field goal unit out there.
Yep. They've got time to get off a pass, completed, and call their final timeout.
But it's got to be quick. A sack takes you out of field goal range, and clock will run out. This is Sisson. Throws the out pattern, complete to Thomas Gordon, who quickly gets out of bounds.
Smart.
At the 30-yard line. 4 seconds on the clock. Well-executed play. Another catch for Thomas Gordon. The senior on senior day is having, well, he's having a Thomas Gordon day.
Boy, that was smart for Thomas Gordon, too. Boy, he didn't hesitate. He just caught it. And number 8-9 went out of bounds right now. Now, this is a long kick. Let's don't give it a sure thing here, but this is about 48 yards. This is well within his range. He's got to hit it right, and the blocking has to be good. Let's see.
Final play of the first half. Grayson Atkins from 48 yards away. It is plenty long. And is always the case with the outstanding All-SOCON kicker. It is very good. Grayson Atkins delivers at the buzzer. It's a 2-score lead for the Paladins. What a first half of football here in Furman. Paladins lead at 32-21. Stats. Halftime in Greenville, South Carolina. Furman and VMI. Paladins have the 32-21 lead. We take a look at these first half highlights. Hamp Sisson earned the starting job at quarterback for the Furman Paladins, making his first start of the season. 12 of 16 in the first half. An impressive performance from Sisson, setting up a couple of Devin Wynn touchdowns. Now, his counterpart, Udinski, is also just a very talented quarterback. It was a big play right here on fourth down and three with his team down by two touchdowns. Hooks up with Jacob Harris. That's the big splash play for the VMI Cadets. But Sisson really had control of this football game, running, passing the Furman Paladins, putting 32 points on the board. And Furman has that 32-21 lead here at halftime. It is a high-scoring offensive game, one we expected. And we will see more of this in the second half continues. Coach Sam Weitsch here with Bob Mahalik at halftime in Greenville, South Carolina. And, Coach, as we take a look at the stats from that first half, what sticks out for you other than the fact that there's a whole lot of offense?
There's a whole lot of offense, and the defensive favor goes to Furman. I mean, Furman's got a better defense than VMI does this year. But their offenses are equal. Honestly, they both pretty much make the first downs they want to make. They make the long plays. The quarterbacks adjust if nobody's open and scramble for big runs. The offensive lines on both sides are doing a terrific job. I don't see a difference there. It's back and forth. The stats show that VMI, if they're ahead at halftime, are 4-0. If they're behind at halftime, they're 0-5. So they're behind at halftime. So I'm going to say that is a plus for Furman.
Advantage Furman.
Yeah, and one that is irrelevant completely.
Yeah. Well, when you look at that board, too, what's amazing is the balance for both teams between rush and pass. It's almost even on both sides. It's just a really well-played football game. And then you look at the bottom there, VMI with one turnover, Udinski with his second interception of the season, second in as many games after going 368 without throwing a pick. But that turnover, which seemed a little bit harmless in the final minute of the game, actually turned into three more points for the Furman Paladins.
Well, it did, and the timeouts that were taken by VMI to try to give themselves a chance to score and match any score that Furman had turned out to work against them because they gave Furman more time that was saved by the VMI team when they were on defense. But that's not a mistake by the coach. It's just the way that it unfolded. I think this half is going to be very similar. Nobody's going to pull their horns in and try to eat the clock up and get it over with.
We'll be back with the second half kickoff in a moment. Seven combined first half touchdowns. Furman leads VMI 32-21. Bob Mahalik along with Coach Sam Weitsch. And Coach, Furman has 32 on the board. Is that enough?
They got 32 on the board. They get the ball first. I am predicting that if they don't score a field goal or a touchdown on this drive, they don't go down, march down and drive, it's going to go down to a flip of a coin at the very end. I think this drive is as important as any of them in the ball game to make sure that they reestablish that offensive domination they've had.
Short kickoff, returnable. Bell will let it bounce, scoop it at the 10. DeJuan Bell out to the 20-yard line. That's where the Paladins will take over for their first drive of the second half.
Don't think I've ever seen a kickoff taken on the first bounce before.
There's Thomas Gordon, the senior, four-year starter, had a terrific first half, 7 receptions, 94 yards, and certainly one to watch here in the second half as this game continues to open up. Paladins have shown many different formations here on offense. Hamp Sisson making his first start of the season. Came into the game last week with the Paladins down 9-0 and led the team on 5 consecutive scoring drives. There was only one drive in this game in which the Furman Paladins did not score. So Sisson basically has been on the field for 10 drives. They've scored 9 out of 10. It's more than just a spark. That's production.
He is impressive, and he was a part of it because a lot of the scrambles by the quarterback is a factor in keeping the drives going. He had guys covered a lot during the game, and he made the right decision just to go ahead and run it. Second down and 8.
Sisson goes under center. Thomas Gordon, the intended receiver, but he's not there, so they go underneath. A terrific read and a catch by Ryan DeLuca for a first down. That play was designed to Gordon. Nope. I believe Sisson checked off of him, saw DeLuca his second option, and it's another catch for DeLuca, his second of the game.
Another factor that makes Sisson, a solid quarterback. Remember, he's a freshman now.
Right.
This is a young guy. Makes him a solid quarterback is that he has judgment. He makes those decisions and doesn't make a foolish throw.
Option, Sisson will keep it.
Not much there. Good defense by the Keydets that time.
And if you missed a little bit of us in the first half, we want to emphasize again that Coach Clay Hendricks was saying in spring and in summer practice and right up to the opening game that the quarterback battle between Darren Granger and Hamp Sisson was neck and neck.
Yep.
And that at the very end, Granger just played just enough better to make him the starter on opening day. Well, Granger got in there and performed very well. Had an outstanding first game against Charleston Southern. Was wonderful on the road against Georgia State. And his struggles began about 3 weeks ago at the Citadel. Coaching staff saying somewhere along the way, Granger lost confidence. And so Sisson has come in, and now Sisson is producing. And as Coach has mentioned several times, they'll need both as the season goes on. Sisson under pressure throws that one away, setting up a third down and long.
How about this is a little sidebar to that. After Atkins made that fifth long field goal at the end of the first half, the first guy that ran out on the field to congratulate him was Darren Granger. He is still all in. He's not discouraged. No, his dauber's not down, as I used to tell our guys. We don't need any of that. You stay in the ball game even if you're not on the field playing, because you never know when your turn's coming back in. And Coach Hendricks has already said both of them are going to be a factor. Both of them are going to get playing time the rest of the way.
Third down and 10. Low snap. Sisson under pressure. Steps up and throws. Complete to Thomas Gordon. Gordon inside the 30-yard line. A huge third down pickup as Hamp Sisson hangs cool in the pocket and throws it complete. Eighth catch of the game for the senior Gordon.
Gordon runs away from the defender and then runs away from the tackle that the defender was trying to make. And on the other end, Sisson climbs up into that pocket, leaving a line of sight down the field to throw. This quarterback's getting better and better as he plays.
Nothing on first down, maybe one. Dominic Roberto.
You know, the other thing, I'm just talking about Sisson a little bit, is that he is so accurate down the field. You notice ball players aren't having to reach behind to make the catch or jump high. They're all landing just about number high, in the chest, in stride.
Well, Sisson certainly has risen to the moment. We wondered, there's a big difference. You come off the bench with no pressure, and you're the hero last week. Now you have a whole week of being the starting quarterback. You have to sleep on it every night, and he shows up like he's done this a million times.
Yep. Furman's got a bright future this year and beyond. And that running game, as we're looking at it, is powerful. Those offensive linemen don't give up on their blocks, and the running backs do not concede a tackle. They try to break one every time they run.
Well, Devin Wynn has 11 carries and 39 yards. Doesn't sound like a monster game, except he has four touchdowns, one of them receiving.
Well, Devin Wynn is a key figure in this offense, and I'll guarantee you they've been working all week to stop that young man.
Wynn goes in motion. Similar setup to the play they scored on when they threw to Wynn on a third and goal situation. So another short yardage situation. We'll see if they throw to Wynn again, who goes in motion. This time they'll give it to Roberto, and Roberto plows forward for the first down.
That was an important third down and two. Now, obviously, kicking the field goal would have been an option if they had made nothing, and would have made it 35-21, which is a 14-point difference. Two touchdowns and two extra points could have tied it up for VMI. But now, obviously, well within field goal range if they need it later on. Otherwise, getting in that end zone would be a big first drive in the second half.
Sisson keeps.
A little bit quick on that one.
On Furman's second touchdown of the game, it came in the first quarter. Devin Wynn had a one-yard run and put them up at the time 13-0. The Paladins went into that fun formation. VMI didn't react, so they snapped it to Jack Harden, who ran it in for the two-point conversion. And that really sort of gave Furman the advantage throughout the entire first half, and it's put them in a situation right now where if they have to settle for a field goal, it is a 14-point lead instead of it being two scores for VMI for them to take the lead. So that 1 point really can make a big difference, and it has throughout the first half in some of the strategy. Sisson throws it to Thomas Gordon. Gordon gets a couple of blocks, cuts it inside the 10, but will be wrapped up before he can get to the first down marker. 10th catch of the game for Thomas Gordon.
Third down and about four, a long four for Furman. Left hash, you got a right-handed quarterback. It's easier for him to roll out to the right or to fake to the left and bootleg to the right. So that's all setting up. Furman, though, in position to make points here of some kind on their first drive.
Gordon goes in motion. He's wide open at the top of the screen. Thomas Gordon makes the catch and is knocked out of bounds at the one as he drops the football, but they're going to say he took a couple of steps and it's a good catch. Great recognition from Sisson as Gordon was running wide open.
On the 1 yard line, they mark it down. Makes the catch. Clean catch. He's got possession, yep, and he loses it out of bounds. So that's after going out of bounds. And well, of course, as soon as he hits that out of bound line, they're gonna review it. But as soon as they hit that ground, the play's over. He's down.
The term is football move. We've been hearing that a lot. Did he make a football move? And then when you watch the replay, yes, he did. He made the catch. He turned upfield, took a couple of steps, and as he lunged forward and fell out of bounds, the ball eventually came out of his hands. But it appears it's going to be the 11th catch of the game for Thomas Gordon. If you'll recall, Clay Hendricks began this football game with the design play to get the ball into the hand of the senior on the very first play of the game, and they've been looking to him ever since. And as we've been saying for the last 4 years, never a bad idea to feature 89.
No, here, let's look at it again. Real close, slow motion.
So there's the catch.
Got possession, makes a football move forward, gets hit. He's out of down, and the ball comes out after he hits the ground. So his butt was on the ground. Excuse me, his buttocks. His buttocks was on the ground. And then the arm fell hard. Actually, if you really want to get details, that elbow hit the ground first before the ball came out as well.
Well, on the professional level, we've seen many plays we thought were catches overruled over the last 5 or 6 years. So let's just make sure,
yeah,
before we make a jump to a conclusion. If it stands, it's Furman ball at the 1 yard line. And Devin Wynn will be in position to get his fifth touchdown of the game.
I suspect it will stand. However, you are absolutely correct. Don't make an early judgment as long as that headset's on that referee's ears.
And they're taking a pretty good look at it.
Yeah. And they're looking at it upstairs and talking to the officials downstairs. You know, in the NFL, they've got those monitors, mobile monitors that they move up and down the field, and even the young ladies in the stands could have reviewed.
They would have made that call. Well, I tell you, it's wonderful, the change of season, because the view here on Furman's beautiful campus is always amazing, but the home stands are in the shade, and it's a little cold today. Let's see if they warm up with this call.
After further review, the ruling on the field of a catch is confirmed. First and goal, Furman.
They got it right.
Yeah, and it's a good thing because it makes us look good. You know what I mean? And that's important to me. I don't know about you. I hate to look like I don't
It doesn't
know
happen that
about.
Often for me. But here's Thomas Gordon again on the ISO. You can see no one within 5 yards of him until he makes the catch. They hit him very well on that play.
Yeah.
Dominic Roberto, who has one rushing touchdown this season, is the running back behind Hamp Sisson. They give it to Roberto. Touchdown, Furman.
Oh, man. That is movement by the offensive line. Now, the running back's going to get the credit for it in the stat sheet. But let me tell you, that offensive line of Furman is blowing the Cadets' defensive line out when they have to.
Defense in the neutral zone at the snap. That penalty to be declined. Touchdown.
Well, you mentioned, Coach, the importance of the opening drive of the second half. And not only does Furman go down and get points, they take 5 minutes off the clock.
Yeah, they're very unforgiving to VMI. VMI makes a good play. Furman makes a better play so far.
Remember, it was a third down and long when under pressure Sisson stepped up and hit Thomas Gordon on a big strike to keep the drive alive. The Paladins in control, leading 39-21. great afternoon at Paladin Stadium for the folks in purple enjoying a beautiful fall day, a crisp autumn afternoon here in the upstate of South Carolina. And right now, the number nine team in the nation, the Furman Paladins, taking it to VMI with a 39-21 lead. Grayson Atkins kickoff goes deep into the end zone. And if you want to see something fun, I'm Bob Mahalik along with Coach Sam Weich, by the way. You got to see us trying to do some math during the timeout here. But with the 39-21, Coach, basically we figured out that VMI probably needs a score in every possession.
Pretty much. You do normally get three possessions, count on three possessions per quarter for each team, and sometimes four possessions if one team is, you know, out three and out real quick, or there's a last-minute, two-minute drive. But, their back is against the wall right now. They can't afford to have to punt maybe once, but no more.
They try and spring Alec Ramsey on first down, but that's not going to happen, and as he is brought down for no gain. Ramsey in the first half, the leading rusher in the Southern Conference, had 112 yards and two touchdowns, including a 49-yarder he broke off for a touchdown in the first quarter. So Ramsey putting up his usual numbers, very productive, 21 touchdowns this season, and he's just a junior. Yudinski, under pressure, goes down. Second sack of the game for the Paladins. Hope had one in the first quarter. That was a team sack there.
Got an injured player for the VMI Cadets. Yep, he's up and around now. He was down for a second. There he goes down in that pile. You see he turned his knee. Good job by the camera work again. Limping off.
So Gill goes out. And it's a third down and long. Hope will get credit for at least a half sack on that play for the Paladins, giving him now a team-leading 5.5. Three-man rush this time for Yudinski. Throws it behind his receivers, incomplete. So VMI's Yudinski throws an interception to end the first half that results in a three-pointer for the Furman Paladins. Now he comes out, and it's three and out.
He's a good quarterback, and he is a quarterback is still learning the game. Let's just put it that way. Sometimes, you make decisions that are not real good. He hasn't really made bad decisions the entire ball game. He's just a solid player, but occasionally there's just nobody open because the defense is strong enough to cover and the pressure's coming on him.
Blackshear and Weems, the corners for the Furman Paladins, have been given a lot of credit by the coaching staff for being out on an island but getting the job done in single coverage, because that's what you're going to face against VMI. They spread the field. It puts pressure on the cornerbacks. And when Blackshear and Weems are having a quiet game, that's probably a good thing, because that means they're not letting anybody get open. Paladins have the football and the lead, 39-21. The shaded side of the field is where the home team is, and it's a little chilly here on a brisk Saturday afternoon, but other than that, the sun is shining all over the Paladins as they lead 39-21, about 7 minutes to go here in the third quarter, and this was a close football game throughout, and it was only towards the end of the half that the Paladins were able to pull away and get that field goal before the end of the half, go up by 11. They scored on their opening drive here of the second half to go up by 18. VMI forced into a three and out for only the second time of the game on their opening drive of the second half. And so now the Paladins in a situation where they can milk clock, run the football, and try and seal this game away.
That's true. And the defense for VMI is it's all on their shoulders. They've got to get the ball back to their offense. And they've had a little bit of trouble doing it with this one right here.
Yeah, Hamp Sisson connects out of the backfield to Devin Abrams. Touchdown, Furman Paladins.
That's one of those runs where you're glad you see the end zone showing up. He was giving out of gas a little bit. What a great play. Perfect throw in stride. Didn't slow him down, and that made the difference too.
You see the formation? Woo. Abrams will sneak out of the backfield, 32, standing next to the cornerback, comes out, and is wide open. That play was open earlier in the football game, and Sisson had it knocked out of the air as he stepped up to make the throw. But this time, there is no stopping Devin Abrams.
You know, I think the defense may be thinking that Furman would pound away, eat the clock up on the ground, and they fake the run and put it in the air for the touchdown, and the extra point is good.
The longest touchdown pass of the season for Hamp Sisson. Longest play for Devin Abrams catching the ball. He had a 69-yard run earlier this year, so you don't expect huge plays out of your fullback, but Devin Abrams certainly has a little more speed than just your average quote-unquote fullback. He's listed as a running back. He sets up as a fullback, but there are a lot of weapons for the Furman Paladins. Abrams certainly one of them.
Well, the game is starting to take shape in terms of who is the better team on the field today. And I think you have to say that this afternoon, Furman is outplaying VMI. But VMI is still so much improved over any year that I've ever seen them play. I think this is. I think that Coach Hendricks was right when he said this is the best they've ever been. And they are getting credit for it, even though their record is not going to be stellar, it's still going to be better.
Well, the gamble by Wackenheim to switch to the air raid offense is certainly paying off. They are leaps and bounds better than they have been in the past. They've got a little bit more speed on the roster, including this guy, young man Brady, who takes it up the gut. He's an all-SOCON performer from the special teams position, and he's out to the 48-yard line. And, Coach, right on cue, that's almost exactly what you're talking about. While maintaining all the integrity of the academic standards they must meet at VMI, they're starting to recruit a little bit better athlete because Wackenheim's opened things up a little bit, and it's more fun to play for this football team.
Yeah, I think that's a big factor. In recruiting is you've given a lot of ball players a chance to play in a game where they know they're going to score some points. That's the fun part of football, you know, not to take anything away from the defense, but watching a guy make a good tackle is not as much fun as watching a guy catch a touchdown pass.
Udinski throws on first down out to Lara.
One thing VMI has is, or they don't have, is they don't have a quit in them. They are fighting back right here. Long return on the special teams, moving the ball here, second down and three in this drive, trying to match that score.
Well, they're built to score in a hurry. Ramsey, close to the first down, will be about a yard shy.
They have to score in a hurry, and they've got to start thinking about and doing the math and thinking about going for two. Because they're going to have to score three or four times, and the extra 2 points could actually equal another touchdown. But you've got to go and make those two-point conversions every time. Furman in a man-to-man.
Ramsey gingerly into the line because of the surge, and he did not get it. Of course, they'll go for it here, but that's going to be a fourth down and one. So he sort of turns away right there and tries to spin off of it, but there just wasn't any room. Donovan Perryman, the senior captain there for the Furman Paladins.
Wait a second. Now, see,
They paused for wholesale substitutions because VMI made a substitution. Furman is given time to make theirs.
Exactly. VMI looked like they were bringing the punt team on, and I don't know if they did that on purpose or not. Maybe they changed their mind and decided they better go for it. They had to.
Udinski could run for it. He will. And gets the first down. Furman almost conceded that with a three-man front. A good read by Udinski.
Yeah. I really don't understand that one a little bit. Why the defensive line was not a big part of that to make sure they didn't pound in for just a really less than a yard.
It was a weird look for fourth and one and have three defensive linemen at the line of scrimmage.
It sure was.
So it's a first down. The clock keeps ticking. Again, empty backfield. And again, it's a four-man rush this time. Udinski throws underneath. And that's where you want Jacob Harris catching passes if you're the Furman Paladins. You'll gladly cede the four-yarder to him.
Yep. Well, that one's about 7 yards. And the shallow cross, Furman's playing a zone right now. They're playing an outside technique by the corners. The linebackers are dropping and looking back. You want him watching for the draw play and the screen plays as well. But you're also going to be able to complete some passes for shorter yardage.
Furman shows blitz.
Bring in a tight end for extra blocking. There's a down the field throw.
Udinski's pass is knocked away at the very last moment.
Boy, we've seen some great receptions by VMI receivers this afternoon, and I thought that was going to be another one, but good defense by Furman. Watch right at the end right here, the effort by the corner.
It's DeMarcus Clay.
I don't think that one's going to be an incomplete pass if it wasn't Clay's last second dive at the ball.
So the safety, Clay, making that move from cornerback to safety this year. First year at safety, already has a couple of picks, makes a great defensive play there. He settled in nicely as well. Another one of those young men will be back next year. Udinski, draw play Ramsey. Ramsey has some room up the middle and picks up the first down inside the 30 to the 28-yard line.
That was on a 3rd and 3, and Furman was in a two-deep zone. Cover 2 in football language. And it means you've got 2 safeties. The corners are up. The linebackers are playing in the middle in their areas, 3 to 3 areas in the middle.
3 receivers to the right, 1 to the top of the screen, and they'll run Ramsey. No, play action. Udinski throws it to the top of the screen, and it is complete to Lahr, making his 4th catch of the game.
That was a big-time play, throw, and pattern. Beautiful pattern run. Timing of the throw was perfect, and they get their first down. VMI is good. I'm telling you, they are better than they're as good as the good teams in the SoCon.
It's still funny to watch VMI go 5 wideouts. You have to get used to it. They've been doing it for a couple of years now, but to see them, you know, chuck the rock like they are here, it's fun to watch. And I'm sure the longtime fans of VMI, it's a little bit of an adjustment. But if you're winning, it doesn't matter, right? And they're winning football games. Remember, this is a team that won 1 game over a 2-year span just a couple of years ago. And now, as we mentioned, they were 3-1 in the SoCon. And if they didn't turn the football over last week, they would have come in here with a chance to win the conference championship. They had a homecoming game last week against Western Carolina in which they were in it the whole way, but they kept turning the ball over. Udinski pumps once, goes to the end zone. Underthrown, an interception. A battle for the football. Chizik's in there, I believe, for the Furman Paladins, and they are going to say it is an interception for Furman.
Beautiful.
Yes, Callie Chizik gets 2 feet in and gets possession of the football. So there's a young man, Chizik, and yes, that Chizik name should sound familiar. His dad is the national championship-winning coach from Auburn, Gene Chizik, but Callie Chizik really been getting a lot more playing time. And the freshman from Auburn, of course, comes in and makes the outstanding defensive play. 2nd interception of the game for the Paladins.
Well, they've been picking on him a little bit in this ball game. You know, they've been throwing to the person that Callie has been covering. That time they went to it one time too many. They're going to review it again to be sure, but it looked like an interception.
They'll review it. We'll let you know if the call stands when we come back.
Ruling on the field of an interception is confirmed. First down.
Play stands. Callie Chizik, congratulations. You've got your first interception as a Furman Paladin. It is a big one and a clutch one. It keeps VMI off the scoreboard. And here's another look at it. Great defense. Both feed in. Possession of the ball and a change at quarterback. Darren Granger comes into the football game for Furman. His first play, he'll pitch it back to
going wide to the outside.
Corey Watkins. And an injured VMI key dead on the play. Mallory. Young man from Maryland had a strong first half, comes limping off, and looks like he'll stay in the game. No, he's going to exit. So Darren Granger comes in the game, a quarterback for the Furman Paladins, as Hamp Sisson will sit, and Granger will try and keep his skills fresh. Last week, both quarterbacks played with Granger starting and Sisson coming in relief. In this game, certainly a different circumstance, but Coach Hendricks staying true to what he's saying and that both guys need to play, both guys need to be sharp. This will help Granger stay sharp for down the stretch, and maybe a huge one next week against Wofford.
You bet. Rangers had some great games. Look at that throw right there. That's what made break for some. Thought they might pull away on that one.
Avery Armstrong almost took that one the distance. Instead, it's a 22-yard pickup, and Darren Granger's on the stat sheet with his first completion of the game.
As we look at it again right there, Darren Granger got practice time, but not with the starting unit during the week. He was throwing as many passes, so he was staying sharp. And as I mentioned, he is not down because he is not playing. He is pulling for the team to win. He's all Furman, great attitude. And that, of course, makes the rest of the team feel comfortable with him around, too.
Well, and Coach Hendricks told us a couple of months ago when Hamp Sisson didn't win the starting job that he handled it well. And he also emphasized that Darren Granger, who was named the starter, handled it well. So there's two ends of that. Absolutely. And they're both very competitive, he says, and he wants that, but they both seem to have a proper understanding of their role as leaders on this football team.
Well, remember, you know, they're both one's a redshirt freshman, the other one's a freshman, so they're going to be together for a long time here.
So Sisson passed for 277, throwing two touchdowns. He now sits, and Darren Granger comes out firing. Was intended for Thomas Gordon. So now it's third down and 11. You see Sisson on the sideline immediately dons the green hat, and he's out there giving either the proper play or as a decoy, calling in plays from the sideline. Passing situation you would think on third down and long with Granger.
Four receivers in release.
Four-man rush. Granger in the pocket. Down the middle. He's got his man. The freshman dropped it. Wayne Anderson had it and had a guaranteed 6 points, and he could not hang on to the football. But the good news there, Granger comes off the bench. Coaching staff says he's lacking confidence. That looks like a confident throw right there.
Not only a confident throw, but great find that right receiver. They had four guys going straight down the field. He had to pick the right one that was open. He did. And unfortunately, it was dropped because the pass was absolutely perfect. Maybe the laces weren't up or something. I don't know.
Well, I mean, Wayne Anderson has good hands, and they've used him coming out of the backfield on several occasions. And
no one
feels worse about it than him. But that was an outstanding throw by Darren Granger. Atkins' kick has a little bit too much juice on it, goes through the end zone. So with a minute 13 to go in the third quarter, VMI will get the football back. The Keydets turned it over on two of their last three possessions.
Furman with 46 points. They gave up seven right there, but you're right. It was good hands. Got it. Wouldn't drop that one, but once in 10 tries, that was the one.
And what a great weapon, Anderson, Abrams, when coming out of the backfield. I mean, we talk a lot about Thomas Gordon is the number one receiver for the Furman University Paladins. But other than that, you know, they don't have a ton of production from DeLuca. They don't use Ryan Miller that much at tight end. Those guys make the plays that they need to make. But really, their key pass catchers come out of the backfield. And we've seen two backs catch balls for touchdowns today for the Paladins.
Yep. A little short underneath Furman in a zone defense again, making sure they don't score quick. And, of course, it gives them the underneath stuff. And they broke one tackle, made a little extra yard with it, got a first down.
I was going to mention that on the previous drive before VMI threw the interception. No way Furman wants to let VMI score. But that last drive, VMI took 4 or 5 minutes off the clock. It was a time-consuming drive, and that plays right into the hands of the Paladins. VMI needs some quick scores, especially now.
Yeah, they've got to virtually score on every possession or make a defensive score, special team score, something like that, to get back into this ball game. Could be done, though.
Kurse and Chizik have interceptions for the Paladins today.
Even this play right here where they're checking off. Oh, it's eating up valuable time.
Screen. Doesn't go anywhere.
Good defense.
Brimajon, the freshman, brought down after only a couple of yards.
Well, they are. Furman has picked up their game. They didn't let that loss to the Citadel keep them out of their effort to win the Southern Conference this year.
Third and long. Everything may be four down territory for VMI at this point.
Team spread out, sprint to the right.
Short in the field. Pass goes incomplete. Again, outstanding coverage by the Furman Paladins defensive backs. And again, the coverage right there was Cali Chizik, who continues to just shine. I mean, here's a freshman. He's 5'9", only 170 pounds. He's got the interception. He's been on the island a couple times with Lara, who's a big play guy for VMI, kept him in check. And here, another good coverage play from Chizik.
I tell you, well put together defense by the coaching staff. Let's give them, you know, a lot of credit. There are a lot of names to mention, so we'll mention them as a group. But those position coaches, I don't ever call them assistant coaches. They are too important. Give them a better title. But the position coaches that have to make sure that their guys are in the right place at the right time with the skills all sharpened make a difference in a ball game. And I always say you should reward the last guy on the list that put everything together, because this is a very tough team sport.
That's the end of the third. Furman leads 46-21. bundle up and have some fun on a fabulous fall afternoon in Greenville, South Carolina. The Foothill Mountains framing Paladin Stadium and the campus of Furman University. The trees are changing colors, and the Paladins are playing very meaningful November football and playing it at a very high level. As Devin Wynn plows forward and picks up positive yardage on a second down and long.
That time they had a little pull. The right guard, Jordan Harris, pulls to the left and leads the ball carrier up into the hole, helping him get his five, actually about almost 6 yards. Here's the look. Let's look at that. Look at 7-1. Team, he's come around. He's opened the hole to begin with, and then if the running back's able to break that first tackler, he's gone because the guard, those unmentioned linemen, those isolated guys that just don't get enough credit. Look out.
Devin Wynn off to the races. He already has 4 touchdowns in this football game. Give him another. Devin Wynn, touchdown, Paladins.
Well, Furman looks stronger and stronger in the SoCon right now in terms of their chances of being the champions at the end of this. They still have to beat Wofford to do it.
A 5-touchdown performance from Devin Wynn.
Wow.
And it's about time you look through those sheets and go, when was the last time a Furman Paladin scored 5 touchdowns in a football game?
I know one thing, this team is playing in sync, that the snap of the ball, everything good is happening.
They've got 53 on the board, number 9 in the nation, looking terrific. The linemen love it when their guy gets 1,000.
Here it
was. Devin Wynn goes over 1,000 yards for the season. His 5th touchdown of the game. The last Paladin to score 4 touchdowns in a game was Jerome Felton back in 2006. Jerome Felton went on to play in the National Football League.
That's right. Wynn came into this with 880 yards. He needed 120 to get over 1,000, so he has now done that.
1,000-yard rusher Devin Wynn comes in as a preseason All-SoCon pick, and he has just dominated games. And he hasn't really been the guy who gets the ball 20, 25 times a game. He puts up those remarkable numbers, touching the ball about between 13 and 18 times a game.
And he comes over and he thanks his offensive lineman when he is after he finishes that and comes up to the sideline. He's appreciative of their job because they can't score touchdowns without that line blocking for you, babe.
Udinski, under pressure, throws it away. If this were the National Football League, of course it is not, and you rush for 1,000 yards, you're buying those Lyman Rolexes, right? Isn't that kind of the common courtesy of the National Football League?
Yeah, you buy them something. It's more than dinner at, you know, dinner at McDonald's.
You get them more than dinner at Chi-Chi's with the free chips, right? They get a little more than that.
Oh, boy. Yeah, there are some, you know, those quarterbacks make a lot of money, and they have a lot of opportunities to give gifts to those linemen because they make a difference in how they play.
But you talk about it being the team game, and Devin Wynn appreciates the linemen as much as the linemen appreciate Devin Wynn, but that's a goal. You know, Clay Hendricks is an offensive lineman and an offensive line coach, so you know that he loves the rushing game, and when you get an individual that hits a milestone, it's not an individual. It's a team effort, and that line certainly has paved the way, and you've seen it today.
Well, I've said it's like a good throw right here. Not quite. No, he did. He broke loose to the first, got the first down out of it. First down's VMI. I've said many times that, you know, it's 11 people having to work in absolute concert with each other. They can't be off at all. At one instant, the snap of the ball. Furman called timeout just in time. They had too many men on the field.
Trying to make some fourth quarter substitutions. Boy, that third quarter, this game was in doubt at halftime. Now, Furman made a big move. They scored a field goal in the last play of the first half, and they got a double-digit lead. But this game was very much in doubt going into the third quarter. You mentioned that first possession, which belonged to Furman, was key. Mm-hmm. Furman marched right downfield, had a couple of key third down conversions, and now they're in complete control of the football game.
You know,
there's no flag on the play for delay of game or substitution infraction. Timeout was called prior.
I didn't hear what he was explaining.
There's no flag. They called the timeout.
There's no flag. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
But you coaches talk about it all the time. That first possession of the second half is so key.
Well, it's key because it sets up your strategy. You kind of re-gear yourself about what you want to do. You want to eat up some clock. You get a little nervous about the score getting tight. And when you go out and score, and Furman's playing the second half, boy, they are playing lights out. I don't think they played any better all season long than they have in this ball game because they're playing a good team. Now, you know, we keep saying VMI, or somebody may be thinking VMI is not a good team. They are a good team this year.
And this is really the first time, other than the game against Marshall, which they began the year with playing an FBS opponent, this is the first time it really hasn't been a fourth quarter game for VMI, especially with that offense. They're in it all the time, but this is the first time they've been down by more than three scores going into the fourth quarter.
Well, they haven't given up. They are driving, making first downs. Problem is that they're not making it in big chunks. They're making it 5-6 yard gains. They'll put one up here in a minute and go deep, like right now.
Ball's incomplete. Curse is back there defensively. He had interception in the first half.
When you are pounding away with that run, you set up the long pass, the fake of the run, and then drop back and throw it. Furman making a lot of substitutions, and they've got to do it in a hurry because there's no huddle on the other side of the ball for VMI.
But VMI made a substitution at wide receiver, and as soon as they substitute, the officials allow the step in and allow the defense to substitute. If VMI doesn't go to the bench, then VMI can snap the ball whenever they'd like.
That's the rule.
Second and 10 underneath. Complete down to the 30-yard line. Ball comes free. No whistle, and the Paladins are taking it back the other way. Down inside the 30-yard line goes Travis Blackshear. There's a VMI player down on the play. There was no whistle, and it appears to be another turnover for the Paladins, and Blackshear deserves that because he's been doing a great job out on an island defending, and he's able to come up with the ball that Weems was able to strip free.
Well, the officials didn't mark the spot of the fumble at all, so there's no question in the officials' minds that there was a true fumble. Furman's football, injured player.
Yeah, Leroy Thomas, who made the catch, is the one who's injured on the play. Thomas, a freshman, has had a fantastic year, more than 50 catches on the season for that young cadet. Last week, he had a big touchdown against Western Carolina.
I'm just observing something here. Look at the player, his teammates around him that were hustling to get back to see after they made the tackle down the field. They went immediately to see how he's doing.
Without being too graphic, Coach, you obviously lived all this. But when you're down on the sideline, sometimes there is a groan or a noise that comes from someone that takes a hit that indicates it's not the normal play.
Oh yeah, you know, sometimes it sometimes you see it. You watch that knee buckle or the elbow gets slammed and it's going the wrong way, and you see it, but. There are times when you actually hear the sound of maybe a broken bone or the sound of the scream, or the grunt, when the guy gets hit the wrong way.
All right, so now they've taken care of the injured player off on the sidelines, and we certainly hope the best for that young man who's got a great future ahead of him at VMI. They're going to review the play to make sure it was indeed a fumble. And Coach, this may have been a situation where instead of the ball being stripped away, God bless him, Thomas may have been in so much pain when that initial twist came that he just dropped the football out of instinct because the pain was so intense in the leg. So we'll take a look at it and see. Weems had the coverage. Weems, a fifth-year senior, was honored before the game today for senior day. Blackshear, a redshirt freshman, picked it up and returned it down to the 30-yard line. So an outstanding performance today defensively from two seniors for the Furman Paladins, Quindarius Weems and Brian Oke, both in the secondary. Both have been here forever, it seems. OK's been here for his 4 years, Weems into his fifth year. They've really done a solid job of keeping VMI and really holding them to 21 points, because Clay Hendricks told us, and everybody across the SoCon knows this, VMI is going to score points. You hold them to 21, you're doing OK.
Yeah, you are.
There you see them taking care of Thomas. Hopefully it's not that bad on the sideline. They continue to review to make sure it was indeed a fumble.
You know, we mentioned earlier in the ballgame, for those that maybe weren't tuned in yet, Elijah McCoy didn't play in this, is not playing today. You got a starter out. Somebody has to step up and play, and the defense looks like they didn't lose a step either. This has been a well-played ballgame for Furman. Well-played by VMI, but Furman has just got a little more horsepower going for him right now in terms of personnel.
Looking ahead next week, SoCon Game of the Year. Furman will go into Spartanburg to take on the Wofford Terriers. That'll be a 1:30 start in Spartanburg next week. That'll be for the SoCon title, and quite frankly, it's for the SoCon title, win or lose for Wofford. Wofford is about to begin their football game at Mercer. Wofford wins, there'll be 2 1-loss teams. Wofford loses, they'll have their second loss in SoCon play, but by beating Furman, they could still put themselves in position to be co-champs.
Yep.
And the Citadel's still lurking, and so is Chattanooga, each with 2 losses. And that's what was a little bit heartbreaking for those fans of VMI last week. They thought they were in position. They got it to 3-1 in the SoCon, got to 3-2. Then they had a home game last week against Western Carolina. It was homecoming, and similar to what happened to Furman, for whatever reason, it just wasn't there. And Coach Wackenheim took some of that on himself, saying he and his coaches didn't have them ready to play. But what really happened was they turned the football over too much.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening today as well.
Turnovers will eat you alive in college, pro, high school, middle school. It doesn't matter. You give the ball up, you give up opportunities to score.
Hey, you turn it over too much on Thanksgiving Day in your backyard, you're not going to win the turkey.
The ruling on the field of a fumble and recovery by Furman stands. First down, Furman.
So the fumble recovery, the first of Travis Blackshear's career.
I think you forgot there's some kind of verbiage you're supposed to use.
Confirmed. Ruling on the field is confirmed.
Yeah.
Furman football at the 30.
Well, sometimes it just doesn't come to you.
We've been there. Probably will be there a lot here the next 12 minutes and 7 seconds.
I've been there many, many times. Here we go. Chance for Furman to really blow this thing open now.
We may have to go searching for the archives. When was the last time that Furman scored 60 or more? Granger rolls into the sun and throws a completion inside the 20-yard line. Down to the 12. Ryan DeLuca.
Good throw. Now, that's a tough throw when you roll to your left and you're a right-handed quarterback. Look at his left shoulder. You see his left shoulder jerk around real quick. He's got to square up to throw it. Threw it right on delivery. Good. Look at it right there as you see it from the backside.
Now, Granger struggled a little bit last week against Western Carolina. Was 4 of 10 and 96 yards. Before that, Chattanooga was only 2 of 7 for 12 yards. But leading up to that, 12 touchdowns, 3 interceptions. Yeah. I mean, Granger can get it going, and you've seen some real strong throws from him here today. And they're going to let him throw again. Yeah. Granger on the controlled rollout. Throws towards the end zone. Jake Walker has it go in and out of his hands, and it's almost intercepted. Ugh. Walker almost had it for the touchdown, and it slipped away.
Had two receivers open that time, and he chose to go down to the one that was almost standing in the end zone and couldn't hold on to it.
It was at his knees, and he tried to scoop it and score instead of going down to the knees to make the catch.
Yeah. That's the I talked about it earlier in the game. You try to hit them above the waist but below the eye level so that ball doesn't get tipped in the air and intercepted or you lose your feet.
Dominic Roberto, who scored earlier in the football game, takes it down to the 10-yard line.
That last pass that Granger threw was a good pass. He should have made the catch. But when you've got two people open like that, it's sometimes easier to hit the guy that's farthest out from you. In other words, you're set up in a line to throw it easier. You got to turn your arm and your hips and your waist and your torso so that you can throw it back across your body. It makes it tougher.
Furman can get a first down at the 4-yard line. Granger under center. And again, a controlled rollout. Granger will keep. Down to the 5, leans forward, and is just going to fall shy of the first down. So they'll mark him down at the 5-yard line, setting up a 4th-and-1 from the 5. Granger had the controlled rollout. Nobody was open. Wise decision to hang on.
And Furman's going to be nice, I think, right here, and kick a field goal rather than go for it, because I firmly believe that they could have made this distance if they chose to do it. But you got a kicker like Atkins. This is what you call money right here.
Kick hits the crossbar. And is that Atkins? Well, they tried it. They tried a different kicker. They're even going with the backup kicker. I didn't think that was Atkins, but they did roll out Timmy Bleckrod, and he comes up with a dinger off the bar. Greenville, South Carolina on a sunny fall afternoon, and the Furman Paladins with their best home performance of the season lead VMI 53-21. And folks, it wasn't always this way. It was 15-14 at one point in the second quarter, but it's been all Paladins since then. And now VMI, keep it on the ground with Brady.
Up for a first down. That's the way they started the game off, offensively, moving the ball on the ground with an occasional throw like this.
New quarterback in for the Cadets as well, Chance Newman, a freshman out of Alabama. Getting some mop-up time here in the fourth, but a good chance for him to face some live action on the road.
Yep, 9 minutes left to go in the ball game. He should get another dispossession and at least one more after that.
Pressure on the young quarterback, and the sack is made from the Furman Paladins. London Lewis from Atlanta, Georgia, out of St. Pius. All 6'4", 280 pounds of them, showing some quickness.
A lot of young players getting a chance to play here on both sides of the ball. Outcome of this game is decided, and now's the time maybe to get a young kicker a chance to kick, and Atkins stayed on the sideline. But
well, I can tell you, Coach, we've done a lot of games in our lives. Very rarely did the backup kickers get into the football game. So and that one did catch it. We weren't prepared for that one. See, there's always preparation to be done, and being ready for a backup kicker is something you need to have in your back pocket.
I'm with you. I didn't even look twice. I figured it would be Atkins, but that's okay. Furman is doing the right thing in letting some younger players play and be a part of this team. That keeps them all close together. They all feel good. Mom and Dad in the audience and the stands up here are happy.
Well, we're sorry, Mom and Dad, that we missed that.
Yep.
Colby Ryder's reception on third down sets up a 4th and 5. Pass is almost intercepted, almost caught, and eventually turns into a turnover on downs because it's well short of the first down. So Laura hangs on to the football with a good defensive play there from Taylor Hodge, a nose guard who's out there getting in the mix with a wide receiver. We'll take our final time out of the football game. Paladins looking to wrap this one up in style, lead it big. Furman looking to go 4-0 at home. They still have one more home game left. They'll take on Point in 2 weeks here at Paladin Stadium. We have our third quarterback of the football game entering for the Furman Paladins, Jack Harden, who has scored in this game. All right, Harden scored in the second, after the second touchdown in the first quarter. Harden took the direct snap and scored the two-point conversion. So he's already on the board, the third quarterback of the game in the ball game for the Furman Paladins, and there's an injured VMI Cadet.
This is the third injury for VMI in this ball game right here. That's a lot of injuries to have to overcome, and they've got a got a couple of games left themselves.
And the one thing VMI will always struggle with is getting a deep bench and getting the numbers.
Yeah.
A military institution is not going to get the amount of numbers that other teams can get. But yeah. Wackenheim's getting there. I really like what I see out of VMI. And if they could have a do-over for last week's game, I think they would have come in here and played even better because they just shot themselves in the foot last week with the turnovers.
Right. And that was against Western Carolina, and it was a team they should have beaten, that they're playing better than the day that we saw Western Carolina. This team right here on the field today is a better team than that one. But they did. They turned the ball over, you lose the game.
So Harden will get up under center, milking clock. They're going to use every ounce of the play clock that they can. Take it inside 10 every time before they even begin to play. They'll run the pitch to Wayne Anderson. Anderson gets to the corner and gets the first down. A lot of stars here today for the Furman Paladins. Devin Wynn, of course, with his 5-touchdown performance. Hamp Sisson, solid performance at quarterback in his first start of the season. And Thomas Gordon, who had 10 catches, 148 yards, first Paladin with 10 catches in a game since 2010. So it was a day of superlatives and super performances from the Furman Paladins, and a day the home folks deserve after that frustrating game 3 weeks ago against the Citadel in homecoming.
Yeah. And you know the guys that are the backup players, the young players that haven't been playing, are sitting around kind of looking out of the corner of their eye at the coach to see if he's going to look over at them. I will
see. Now that I could relate to, Coach. You can talk about Super Bowls. I'm the guy standing there waiting for the coach to see me to put me
no,
in.
I can relate to. In fact, I'll tell you one. Super Bowl VII, back in the 1972 season, I'm a backup quarterback to Billy Kilmer. Sonny Jurgensen was injured all season, and I'm the backup, and we're playing the Miami Dolphins. You know, they have a perfect record. And Billy's having a tough day, a real tough day, and the only score we had was Garo Yeprimian throwing an interception that day. And I'm looking over there loosening up, watch, and I'm getting a little nervous because I'm going to have to go in that ball game and try to pull it out. But it didn't happen. They stayed with Billy Kilmer. We ended up losing 14-7.
Yeah, still was a close game, right?
Yeah, it was a good – but really, we couldn't –
At that time,
anything going offensively.
As a player at that time, it was the 7th Super Bowl. Do you have any idea how iconic and how American the Super Bowl would become?
No. It was an interesting extra game, honestly. We really didn't consider it a big star on your resume. But it was fun, and we were playing a game out in Los Angeles in the Coliseum, and they had a full house, so it was a big deal. Right now is a big deal with some of these young guys can make something happen, and they're doing it.
Harden to Walker, and Walker hits the pylon, but they'll say his foot went out of bounds at the 1 yard line. Jake Walker almost got it in for the touchdown.
First down and goal at the 1 is a very good position. Whether you are a young player getting your feet wet here today or not, here's a chance to score in a regular season game.
So Harden completes the pass. So now 3 Furman quarterbacks have thrown completions. See if Harden, who has a 2-point conversion, can just sneak it in himself here. First and goal from the 1 yard line. Straight handoff up the gut and in for the touchdown. Jeff McElvin. First career touchdown.
It's a big moment, my friends, I will tell you, for a young player getting his chance to play and getting, whether he's a blocker or a running back or the guy that handed the ball off, he was on the field when they scored.
No man from Goose Creek down in the low country. 59 points are on the board. So the Paladins put 60 on the board against VMI. They put 58 on the board on the road. See, you get the backup kicker in there, too, getting this touchdown as Timmy knocks it through. So there you see it. It was a very competitive game through most of the first half. Big finish of the first half for the Furman Paladins, and then 28 unanswered points here in the second half. They've scored on every possession led by Hamp Sisson. That's a carryover from last week. Remarkable performance. Devin Wynn goes over 1,000 yards for the season, 5 total touchdowns, and Thomas Gordon with a senior day performance that he'll remember for a long time. 10 catches, 148 yards. You talk about a complete game. I think Clay Hendricks got it from everybody. And, of course, Grayson Atkins made his 48-yard field goal. Special teams have been solid as well, except for one return that they'd like to have back that they gave up, a 45-yard return. Other than that, solid performance from the
made
Paladins.
A big game. And from the standpoint of a useless fact, VMI, if they're trailing at halftime, was 0-5 coming into this game.
Yep, they were down at half.
And they're now 0-6.
So it wasn't a useless fact.
Well, it is,
it
and I want you to work hard on trying to find a way to work that into a conversation later this week.
I will do that. Well, we got a home game coming up in 2 weeks against Point, so we'll have a lot to talk about then. Atkins gets it through the end zone. Touchback. So a 60-point performance from the Furman Paladins.
And, of course, the next week is Wofford, which is a big game on the road.
It's everything.
And then Point is a non-conference game. So this coming week will be a important week of practice for both Wofford and Furman. Both of them have a lot on the line. Arch rivals, longtime rivals.
And Wofford is up 13-0 on the road right now. So if all stands there, the Terriers and the Paladins will meet next week in Spartanburg, each with one loss. And then Wofford does have to end up the season with one more conference game. So there is a chance they can get knocked off at the end. But it's a de facto championship game next week in the SoCon. It's right where the Furman Paladins want to be. And, Coach, you don't want to let this thought slip into your mind. But if the Paladins lose next week, you would assume, as the number 9 team in the nation and 2-loss team in the SoCon, they're still a playoff team, correct?
You would assume. But, that you know, it's uncertain. You want to earn it, lock it in, and Furman is certainly going to be they'll be in a battle with Wofford, but Furman's playing about as well right now at the end of the season as I've seen them play during the season, so you would think that it's going to be one whale of a ball game up there. It'll be a big crowd. Furman will have a big following, and, of course, Wofford brings a lot of people to all their home games. Be fun.
Well, you looked at the schedule, and you hope that's what it would be.
Yeah.
You know, we looked at that schedule in the summertime. We're like, look at that. There's a late game in Spartanburg. That could be for it all. And if the pre-conference predictions are true, it's going to come down between Furman and Wofford.
Yep, and Clay Hendricks even said we're playing meaningful games here at the end of the season. And that one certainly will be a meaningful game, big one.
Wofford is now up 20-0 on the road, and the Terriers have nosed their way back into the top 25, ranked 23rd. So it'll be a SoCon showcase next week. It'll be for the SoCon championship. It'll be between a top 10 team, Furman, and probably a top 20 team at that point, Wofford. It's everything you want from a late November conference game.
Right. Furman making a lot of substitutions on the defense. Actually, special teams making some substitutions.
Yeah, Bell will try and return this kick.
Players are getting in the ball game, getting.
And Bell will walk it out of bounds. And what's even more important, I shouldn't say more important, the SoCon Championship is what you play for. You want to have that. And as we said, Clay Hendricks has won a championship in the Southern Conference as a player, as an assistant coach. He's been involved in 10 of them. He'd love to get one as a head coach, and he's certainly in position for that now. But Furman's having such a strong season that if they win next week, not only the SoCon champs, they're looking at a potential bye situation in that first round of being one of the top seeds in the country.
And that is important because this has been a long season anyway. Your injuries may or may not be a big factor of different teams, but a week's rest can certainly pay off. You got to be careful that you don't lose the rhythm of the season, that you keep the guys' attention on the game. They don't lose any of the details, but I don't think Furman will have that problem.
Paladins are about to make it 26 wins in the last 27 games against VMI. The Key Dads did win in Greenville, but it wasn't here at Paladin Stadium. They've never won here in Paladin Stadium.
That was at Old Serene Stadium where I used to play when I had my tourney bat back in the 60s.
And let me tell you, both look good. Both you and Serene Stadium both holding up well.
You are lying right through your teeth.
That's
right
not
now.
True. They gave a little facelift to Serene Stadium where Greenville High School plays their home games. It looks good.
Yeah, well, that's
it's
half
like
of
you
what
with,
you
it's
said.
It's like you with makeup.
Serene Stadium is looking good, but that's the only part of that sentence. Factual. Greenville High School is really enjoying it now. Nice run right up the middle. Good blocking up front by the offensive line. Guys getting a little chance to do their thing. Believe me, this is a lot of fun when you know that the tension of winning and losing a ball game. The game's won. Now you get a just chance, to, almost like practice, get out there and just have fun.
Clock ticks. We're under a minute to go. Special thanks to our crew. Did a great job today. We love the ISO cam. Took you inside the line of scrimmage, I think, throughout this ballgame, focusing on the offensive line of the Furman Paladins, who deserve an awful lot of credit for this team's top 10 ranking. One of the top run teams in the nation, more than 500 yards of total offense today. And it all begins at the line of scrimmage. It all begins with a very talented group of guys up front who've really come together this year. Layton and Crowburn, Jumper and Neely. Jumper's back in the starting lineup ahead of Neely and Harris and Godwin, and Bo McKinney's played a role too. They're deep, they're talented, and they may carry Furman a long way. That will be the final play of the football game. A tremendous effort from the Furman Paladins as they put 60 up on the board, and they beat the Keydets 60-21. Devin Wynn with a 5-touchdown performance, a historic performance for the running back from the Furman Paladins. Hamp Sisson now 1-0 as a starting quarterback. And next week, Furman heads to Wofford, where they will play for the SoCon Championship and a chance to maintain their top 10 ranking in the nation. So once again, a big thank you to our crew. Worked very hard today. Our Furman-based crew, a lot of young people know how to get it done in the production booth. We appreciate everybody. For Coach Sam Weich, I'm Bob Mahalik, saying remember, you can watch these games being streamed throughout the week on ESPN Plus and ESPN3 and ESPN.com. Go back and watch it again if you're a Furman Paladin because you'll like what you see. The Paladins get the 60-21 win. So for Coach Sam Weich, our entire Furman-based crew, I'm Bob Mahalik, saying goodbye from Paladin Stadium in Greenville, South Carolina.